10 and SEC battle. So you get a trifecta of Big Ten versus SEC games, and this will get it started.
These guys jumping around a little bit. The Badgers, they're still playing football despite the thrashing by the Buckeyes.
Put it behind them.
Yes.
Ready to go in the Outback Bowl.
Onward.
That's next on ESPN2. Enjoy your New Year's Day.
Welcome to Capital One Bowl Mania.
Welcome to Raymond James Stadium here in Tampa, and welcome to ESPN's coverage of the 2015 Outback Bowl, part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Happy New Year, and the fans are set for football here in Tampa. It's number 19, Auburn, and number 18, Wisconsin. SEC meets Big Ten, and that's a theme here in Tampa that's been a bowl theme so far. The SEC against the world. Hi again, everyone. I'm Bob Wischusen alongside Matt Millen, and Quinn Kesnick will join us in just a moment. Barry Alvarez told his team, and he is on the sideline today, obviously, for Wisconsin. This is a game about attitude. Coming off the Big Ten championship game for Wisconsin, coming off the Iron Bowl for Auburn. Both teams disappointed with losses. Who wants to be here more? That's the question today.
And who wants to win here more? And both teams getting drilled in those respective games. And then on top of it, coaching changes, hard coaching changes within the organization, and brings you down here, and it is attitude. And it's control what you can control. Your attitude is the biggest one. How you prepare, what you're going to study. All those things come into play, and we'll see if they pay dividends here in the game.
Well, one thing we know is going to come into play, both of these teams, they're going to try to run the football.
Oh,
because
yeah.
We've got two outstanding running backs. We'll start with the SEC's rushing leader, Cameron Artis Payne.
Cameron Artis Payne, week in and week out, saw some of the toughest defenses in all of college football. And when you watch him, he is one of those guys that just does everything right. He's a good inside runner, has great balance, has good power, catches the ball well. He's excellent in protection. He's a student of the game, so he knows exactly what's going on up front. He's one of those guys you can depend on, game in and game out. And guess what? Next year, you'll be watching a lot of him, too, because he'll be playing in the stadium near you.
I have a feeling that the other guy in this afternoon's game might be playing on an NFL stadium near you next year as well. Melvin Gordon, a finalist and the runner-up for the Heisman, sets a brand new rushing record, breaking Wisconsin's Ron Dayne record in 1996, most rushing yards in the Big Ten. He wins the Doak Walker Award as the nation's top running back, and we're getting a look at why.
Yeah, and what he can do is he can break it from anywhere in the field. He has great speed, but he also has good patience on the inside. And so how do you play him? Well, I think what you'll see here is a blueprint of what Ohio State did the last time they were out. And what they did is they played 9-man fronts, more than 8, one more on top, and then they were just very physical. Now, to Wisconsin's credit, they had a shakeup in their offensive line, and Barry Alvarez has been able to handle that and get the people back in. They're healthy, and that should bode well for their running game.
For the second time in 3 years, Barry Alvarez coaches the bowl game for Wisconsin. He'll be joining Quint Kesnick when we come back to Tampa, and apparently his message received by Melvin Gordon.
Don't walk off this field in tears, man.
No.
We got Auburn. Bring him out. Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
Bring him out.
His squad.
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 Welcome back to Tampa. Just about set for kickoff here in the Outback Bowl. It's Wisconsin and Auburn. And again, Barry Alvarez coaching the Wisconsin Badgers in the bowl game today. And he's standing by with Quint.
Coach, how have these young men reacted to the loss in the Big Ten championship game, coupled with the loss of head coach Gary Anderson?
They've been resilient. They bounce right back. The coaching staff has been very professional. They haven't missed a beat. The kids have really given us their full attention in practice, and I think they're ready to play.
What is your role today?
I'm going to manage a game.
What are your emotions right now?
Just like the old days.
Thanks, coach.
All right, Q, thanks very much. And Matt, when Barry Alvarez says, I'm going to manage the game, what does he mean by that?
Well, that means what he's going to do is take the big picture, macro view. He's going to let his offense and defensive coordinators do the specifics. So they'll be in the game plans heavy, because they have been. But he'll time manage. He'll tell them when to go for things. If you're going to go for it on fourth down, that type of thing. It's a macro view. And really, it's a CEO view. But, shoes, that last comment, just like the old days, you can't take the fight out of the dog.
No, he puts the headset on, and it is back to Camp Randall on Saturday afternoons for Barry Alvarez. Andrew Endicott will kick it deep. Corey Grant and Rudy Ford back for the Tigers on Wisconsin. War Eagle. It's the Outback Bowl here in Tampa. And Grant will take a knee. So we spent in our open plenty of time talking about Cameron Artis Payne, and rightfully so. When you lead the SEC in rushing, you've had an amazing season. But what about the career now of Nick Marshall? He is number 6 in total offense in Auburn history, number 3 in total touchdowns, number 6 in touchdown passes, and this for a player that wasn't originally thought to be a quarterback.
Two things with Nick Marshall. He surpassed anything anybody thought he could do. And he's gotten nothing but better over the course of two seasons. And here's the bigger piece. He's a bigger man than people think. This kid's 215 pounds, and he's got great speed. Very athletic.
Talk about stacking the box as well. How about Wisconsin? Creeping 7 players right up near the line of scrimmage. And Ricardo Lewis starts with an end around and starts it well for Auburn as we take a look at today's impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
Well, one of the things that you watch with Sammy Coates is his ability to break a defense. He's got great speed down the field, and that will be a factor in this game. And strong safety Mike Caputo is a guy who's got to be involved in this run game. They'll keep him around the line of scrimmage.
Marshall brought down behind the line. So just like that, with Marcus Trotter making the stop, Wisconsin forces a third down.
Yeah, and so this is what they're going to have to be able to do. They're going to have to be aggressive up front, and they're going to have to play man on the outside, which, when you're doing that, you're taking a chance with Sammy Coates, because he can get on top of any coverage.
Well, Sammy Coates did not get the start with this Auburn group. We were told he was going to start the game. He was not out there with the ones when they were running through their 7-on-7 pregame, and he's not out there now. Cameron Artis Payne didn't get there as well. He's about a half yard shy. Warren Herring submarined Artis Payne. So it looks like a 3 and out for Auburn to start.
That is a huge deal for Wisconsin. And I'll tell you where, in the confidence department. They're not very big up front. Herring's about the only guy who has any kind of size, which is kind of weird when you say it's a Herring has size. But he's a good, tough player inside, and that was a needed third down stop.
Daniel Carlson handles all the kicking duties for Auburn. Redshirt freshman, not only the place kicker, but also the punter. And Kenzel Doe is a dangerous return man. The rugby-style kick might keep it away from Doe, and it does. Well done by Carlson. All the way down to the 11-yard line. So field position not working in Wisconsin's favor as Joel Stavi, the redshirt junior, will take the field for the first time. Now, he does not put up nearly the prolific numbers that a Nick Marshall does, but he wins. He came on in relief of Tanner McAvoy against Northwestern, threw 3 interceptions. That was a loss for Wisconsin, but since then, he is 7-1 this year as a starter and 20-7 as a starter for his career.
He's going to have to play his best game today. If I'm this Auburn defense, I stack the box, go man outside, and make Stave be your left hand. Beat me left-handed.
Melvin Gordon in motion, flexed out. Stave under some pressure, throws across his body, wide open up the sideline. He's got the tight end, Arneson. All the way out to about the 37-yard line. That's a gain of 26. First play for Wisconsin.
Well, there are some keys that Wisconsin has to be able to have. And the first one is handle Melvin Gordon, and that means load the box. The second thing, Stave has to have himself his best game. And that's a great start for Stave, because so much of this game is about confidence and how you start, like we talked about in the open. Control what you can control. Attitude's the bigger piece.
Our keys to the game brought to you by Franklin American Mortgage. And the first carry for Wisconsin brought to you by Melvin Gordon. And he stopped by Chris Frost after a gain of 2.5. And Matt, we knew, based on talking to the Wisconsin coaches yesterday, this first quarter is going to be on Joel Stavi as they go hurry up. And he's got all kinds of time. Swings one to Gordon behind him and a loss of a couple of yards. It'll be 3rd down and 10.
Part of the confidence has to come from his offensive line. Now, the last time out, they were in a championship game and they got drilled. What happened was in the interior of that offensive line. You see Volts right here, the center. He's back, he's healthy. That means that's a big deal, because with him out, it affected essentially 3 positions. Now they can take Llewellyn and put him back to guard, and then they're solid across the front.
And in communication, it's a big deal, especially on third downs for protection.
Stavi bullets one to the sideline, and there's the flag. Alex Erickson, the leading receiver for Wisconsin, tied up with Jonathan Mincy, and it looks like it will be a first down for Wisconsin.
Okay, so if you look at the matchup, Mincy, not a real fast guy. Auburn is a guy, I mean, Auburn's defense should have the advantage in terms of coverage.
Defense, number six, spot foul, automatic, first down.
I misspoke. Erickson's not a real fast guy, so Mincy has the advantage there. He had the advantage really because he's holding him by the chest.
There comes a 13-yard penalty, puts the ball right at midfield. Alex Erickson, 51 catches this season. The rest of the active wide receivers today for Wisconsin had 37 catches combined. So Erickson is the go-to guy for Stavi, no question. A little jet sweep to Corey Clement. He's loose to the 30. Clement down to the 10-yard line and knocked out of bounds at the 5. They'll say he stepped out at the 7, first and goal Badgers.
Clement had an advantage. He caught Auburn in man-to-man coverage. So what does that mean? Watch these two guys outside. They're going to stay with their coverage, and it widens the field. And then it makes them more blockable. Clement's able to take that lane to the inside because they secured the edge, and you're first and goal.
Corey Clement is the roommate of Melvin Gordon and the heir apparent to Melvin Gordon. He should be the guy next year for Wisconsin.
Well, you talk about loading the box. Look at this. Nobody moving out.
And a rollout for Stavi. Has a connection into the end zone. Guess who? Corey Clement. Touchdown, Badgers.
That's exactly what Wisconsin had to do. One, they needed a fast start. They were able to do it. Two, Stavi has the production they're looking for. Not only does it give him confidence, but it gives this offense some confidence.
How much does that first drive loosen up that Auburn defense, knowing that Wisconsin wants to give the ball 30 times maybe to Melvin Gordon?
Yeah, that's a big piece right there. In this puzzle of a game, Clement is the wild card here early, but Stave's the one who produces, and he's the one that they have to be aware of.
What a start. Already 7 push-ups for Bucky Badger as Wisconsin's got the touchdown lead over Auburn. A reminder, if you miss video of the touchdown of Corey Clement, is now posted on the SportsCenter app, available on your mobile devices and tablets. And we'll see if Sammy Coates is available on this second offensive possession for Auburn as the Tigers about to get the football back, but they trail by a touchdown. Bob Schusen, Matt Millen, and Quint Kesnick here in Tampa.
Shoes, that was huge for Wisconsin. They are notoriously a slow starting team. They needed a fast start in this game, and they've got that first part down.
Corey Grant again will take a knee and bring it out to the 25. And Quint Kesnick is down on the Auburn sideline. And Q, plenty of wide receiver drama today for Auburn.
Now we can start with Duke Williams, their leading receiver with 45 catches. Suspended for a violation of team rules, he will not play. Quote, I let the Auburn family down. Now he has been practicing. He is here on the sideline supporting this team. He's actually wearing his uniform today. Interesting though, Sammy Coates, their other stud receiver, had a huge game against Alabama, did not play in the first series. He remains on the sideline. Banged up a lot this year with that knee injury. I don't see a knee brace on him. He looks good to go. Just hasn't had his number called yet.
That's interesting.
A little bubble screen. Quan Bray is introduced to Peniel Jean, and that's a loss of a couple.
Hello, Mr. Jean. How are you? Having a good day? What are you doing? Oh, just knocking into people around here. That is a good read by Jean. One he'll have to be careful of. That aggressiveness
jumping this throw will make that be a pump and then get behind him. So he'll have to be careful as the game goes on, but well played.
Good throw outside by Marshall. Makes it third down and manageable. Marcus Davis with his 12th catch of the season, tied up by Darius Hillary.
That's important by Hillary. Now, one of the things you're going to have to always do against an Auburn offense is tackle well in space, whether you're in the passing game or in the run game. Here we go in third down. Let's see if that tackling in space doesn't come into play yet again.
It's a strength of both teams, offensively for Auburn, defensively for Wisconsin. Marshall on a rollout. And an easy pitch and catch to Quan Bray. First down, Auburn.
You know, Shoes, one of the things that we've heard as they go to the hurry up, they're saying, you know, you got Duke Williams, he's out, and now you look on Sammy, coaches and playing. They have kids down there, you just don't know their names yet. Quan Bray is one that's legit.
Artis Payne for three.
And oh, by the way, they have Cameron Artis Payne inside, who the more you watch him, the more he grows on you. He'll be playing in the NFL. He's got toughness. He's got a solid confidence about him. No matter what position you put him in, as Sammy Coach is in the field now, no matter what position you put Payne in, he's ready to play and able to do it.
Great. Sammy Coates on the field, and guess who? Nick Marshall wants deep. Incomplete at the 5-yard line.
And guess who knew he was on the field as well? They had the safety cutting him underneath, and they kept the corner on top of him the whole way. And that's what you have to do. That Shelton, the corner, you see how he's just taken off deep, and you see the safety coming from under. Sammy Coach kills you when he gets on top of your defense.
Is he bracketed and doubled on every play, or are there times where he'll be on an island?
He'll be on an island a couple times, and you're still going to give him the cushion, let him beat you underneath.
Third down and seven. Wisconsin looking for their second stop. They bring a blitz. Marshall's in trouble. Trying to extend the play. Has no chance to get the first down. Two defensive stops for the Badgers. Joe Schobert made the stop, and it's going to be a punt for Auburn.
They give you a lot of different looks, does Wisconsin's defense. Schobert has good speed. He runs inside out, doesn't make the tackle, makes the play.
So again, Daniel Carlson will try and pin Wisconsin deep. Kenzel Doe at about the 10-yard line. He has 9 punt returns this season of 15 yards or more. So we've got two good return men in this game, and Bray and Doe. Kenzel Doe will save some real estate at the 11-yard line by fielding it on a hop. So the second straight possession that Wisconsin starts at their own 11. First time around, they scored a touchdown. Have had getting set for the Outback Bowl. Not only are you in Florida, so it's warm, you've got the beach right over the bridge here in Tampa. You get to go out and have a lot of fun, go to Busch Gardens and visit the animals. And on top of that, you get to eat Outback Steakhouse food the entire week. There are worse places to be if you're a college football team than the Outback Bowl on New Year's Day.
Can you say Bloomin' Onion?
Back to work, Wisconsin, this time from their own 12-yard line. Here's Melvin Gordon. Speaking of Melvin Gordon, our impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A.
Well, it's an easy one. It's Melvin Gordon, the nation's leading rusher. And what he does is he has the breakaway speed and big playability, but he also has good patience, as you saw in this last play. Jonathan Ford, the safety from Auburn, just his first year playing safety, this kid's got a chance to be really special. He's got to work on his angles coming down, but he's a guy who can change direction, make you miss, a former running back. He's got a chance to be a really good player.
And he made that stop. Gordon again. moving the pile, very close to a first down. It looks like he has the first down. And Melvin Gordon, the Doak Walker Award winner for the nation's top running back. Yep. Obviously, with over 2,300 yards rushing, fourth in NCAA history. What a year.
And why what a year is because of what you saw there. It's just subtle. He's patient shoes. Not a lot of runners have that, who have that kind of speed. Their first inclination is to try to bounce it outside. But he has good inside patience, and that separates him from the pack.
Again, it's Gordon for about two more yards. Now, talking about Melvin Gordon and the season he had, obviously this week, he was asked about going up against an SEC defense. And Melvin Gordon's take was, I went for 140 on LSU. You can call it what you want. I can't help that I'm in the Big Ten. I feel like I can do what I do if I was in the SEC or whatever conference. Of course, Cameron Artis Payne was asked about his take on what Melvin Gordon accomplished and the fact that he was the leading rusher in the SEC. Here was his quote. I'm just going to say I would have loved to have played against Northwestern, Illinois, and Purdue as well. Alex Erickson close to a first down. So both running backs taking not so subtle shots across the bow at the other. And it really, Matt, it underscores what this game is all about. And I think what bowl season has become largely about, and that sure. is the SEC against the world. Everyone views ESPN, college football in general, as having an SEC bias. Wisconsin wants to win this game in a big way to prove that they belong on the same field as Auburn.
Every conference knows they have to carry their respective flags. And they want to prove whether you're the ACC, whether you're the MAC, whether you're the SEC, whether you're the Big Ten, whatever you are, you want to carry the flag and say, look, we're pretty good, and let me prove it to you.
Play action for Stavi. Looking for the home run ball for Erickson. Broke it up.
That's on Stavi. Erickson had half a step. He needed to throw that ball to the middle of the field. It hung a little bit and allowed the safety to come back. But whoa, what great protection up front for Stavi, which underscores not a pass rush. But watch when he breaks to the inside. See the little subtlety of getting him on his edge. This ball needs to be thrown out here. It was underthrown, and that's the difference in the play. Look at this protection. He could read Tolstoy back there. And that takes a long time, trust me.
Jonathan Jones and Jonathan Mincy both had the bracket on Erickson. So now it's second down and 10. Clement, it'll be third down and long. He picks up a yard, so third down and 9 coming for Wisconsin.
So Auburn is saying, look, we're gonna continue to do with our game plan. We are going to let Stavi try to beat us. Okay? We're going to match up man outside. We're not going to let Melvin Gordon get going inside. And now on third down, you can give yourself a little bit of pass rush room. And by that, it means you might want to dial something up here because you know you're still going to go man. Look at across the board. They're manned across.
Here comes the blitz. It's a six-man rush. Stavi up the seam. Too high for Kenzel Doe. So Auburn gets a stop.
Doe had him. He leveraged him. Stavi has to see that. It has to be back inside. Here he is. What he wants to be able to do is attack this guy and get him on the outside. Then you have the inside to be able to beat. The safety's going to be deep. There's your throw right there. It has to be inside the safety to the inside of the defender. It was there, and Stavi missed him.
Kenzel Doe only listed at 5'8", so that's a tough throw for Stavi to make as well. And it results in a fourth down. This is a terrible punt from Drew Meyer. And it takes an even worse bounce for Wisconsin. Out to about the 42-yard line. That's a 23-yard punt. Great field position for Auburn.
The 2015 Outback Bowl is brought to you by Outback Steakhouse. Outback, no rules, just right. And Aflac, ask about it at work.
Both teams had a great week here in Tampa. At the Outback Bowl, a big dinner sponsored by the bowl host, of course, Outback Steakhouse. visits to children's hospitals in the area, a bowling competition team against team, and they just delivered that to the booth. That's the biggest blooming onion in the house, but there is one in the booth now, and I might be on my own on this drive.
You are going to. This shrimp is off the charts.
Nick Marshall goes to work. There's the first catch for Coates, uses a stiff arm. And Sammy Coates is close to an Auburn first down, and Matt Millen will digest. It's now second down and one.
Well, what's it? There's the shrimp right there. It tastes a lot better than it looks, trust me. Sammy Coates is a physical freak. He'll bench over 400 pounds. He'll run in the 4.3s. He's got all the measurables you want, and he's just scratching the surface of how good a receiver he can be.
False start. Offense. Number 72. 5-yard penalty. Second down.
What I mean by that is he's a guy, he runs a lot of nine routes, which are deep down the field, just streaks, just take off. And he can do that because he has great speed and can get on top of a receiver, and he contests for a ball very easily. But he'll need to learn how to run his routes better. And when he gets that down, he's really going to be he's going to be hard to stop.
Five-man rush. Marshall over the middle. Low throw. Is it scooped up? Looks like Marcus Davis has a first down. And even more importantly, we have this.
More importantly, you can hold it and show the people you can do that. I'm going to show you how it's eaten.
Here goes Artis Payne. Dodging tacklers down to about the 33-yard line. And we're happy. That's all we need to say. We're very happy. Again, I think I'm on my own on this drive.
This is outstanding. You got to try it.
That's not all yours, by the way.
This is as good as Cameron Payne.
No, I get a couple of those also. Artis Payne. Close to another Auburn first down.
Artis Payne got great toughness. Not the easiest road to get here to Auburn. He started out at Harrisburg High School. Didn't have the grades. Went to Milford to get a prep school, then went out to California to a junior college. They found him as the top running back in junior college. And then for 2 years here, he's been nothing but getting better. His best days are ahead of him.
Third down and about a foot. Right up the gut, easily for a first down, goes Cameron Artis Payne. Inside the Wisconsin 25, a gain of 7.
Wisconsin defensive front is not very big. I mentioned to you earlier, Herring's the only guy who has any kind of size, and this Auburn offensive line is big.
They're not wasting any time either. Down close to the 20-yard line.
And in the center of that group, Dries Dismukes, number 50, their center. Remington winner. As the best center in college football, had a great year. However, in the Alabama game, did not play very well. And that hurt this offense. He needs to be playing at his high level, and it looks like he's off to a great start.
Marshall to Bray. Fights his way down to about the 1-yard line. First and goal for Auburn. A gain of 20 as Quan Bray stopped at the 2.
They go to their hurry up right away.
Artis Payne into the end zone. War Eagle on the board. An extra point away from a tie.
That's what they were looking for. And they did it on the legs of Artis Payne and Nick Marshall with some early throws. Once you soften up and get people off a little bit, Payne's able to take advantage with that size differential of this Auburn offensive line.
12 rushing touchdowns for Cameron Artis Payne. First team all SEC. Caps an 8-play, 58-yard scoring drive. And we are tied at 7.
You will never see this shrimp.
Cameron Artis Payne. He was the workhorse on the drive, but it was Quan Bray that got the Tigers down to the 2-yard line. Artis Payne polishes it off, and we're tied at 7. The NFL. NFL playoffs start on ESPN. Cam Newton and the Panthers, they've won four straight. They host an eight-time Pro Bowler and Larry Fitzgerald and the Arizona Cardinals. It's win or go home for two NFC teams trying to prove they belong. The NFL playoffs, the wild card round. Cardinals, Panthers, Saturday at 4:20 Eastern on ESPN. And, of course, the 2010 Heisman winner, I would imagine, might be watching his old team play as we speak. Because, of course, Cam Newton had one of the all-time historical years for a college football quarterback back in 2010.
Well, Cam is playing better because his team around him is playing better. Defensively, they're really starting to play really well.
From the 3-yard line, Ogunbowale brings it out to about the 21. And that's the best field position so far for Melvin Gordon and the Wisconsin Badgers, as Melvin Gordon has now passed Marcus Allen the most rushing yards in a single season in FBS history, trailing only Kevin Smith and Barry Sanders. And when we brought those names up and we talked about Barry Sanders, Matt, that's your era of playing football. You talked about what it was like to try to catch Barry Sanders on a football field.
Yeah, good luck with that. That guy was phenomenal. I played, you know, I drafted Kevin Smith, who played with us up in Detroit and had a good little run there. And then I played with Marcus Allen. Now, you start talking about the people in that level, that's a whole nother level. But I've never seen anyone like Barry Sanders. I've thought and still think he's the best runner I've ever seen, best pure runner. Marcus Allen is a lot like Cameron Payne, Artis Payne. Tough guy, does everything right. Bigger than Artis Payne, but very versatile. Of course, he's a Hall of Famer.
Looks like Leon Jacobs shaking up on that play on the return for Wisconsin. Has to be helped off the field. And the Badgers will start at their own 21-yard line. Their opening possession, they started at their 11, went right down the field and scored a touchdown. Their second possession started at their own 12. So,
but Shoes, here's what's going on. Okay, Auburn is still saying, okay, Stavi, go ahead and beat us. We're not letting Gordon beat us. They're still sticking with it. They haven't deviated at all from their initial approach. They're going with tight coverage on the outside, loading that box up inside. Here comes a safety walking down right now. You're going to have an eight-man front again. Now, Gordon's run a ton against eight-man fronts.
And he finds room to about the 25-yard line for a gain of four. How hard is this game to coach for Wisconsin with the uncertainty going forward? We know Paul Christ is the new head coach, and that's a Wisconsin guy. That was a guy that Barry Alvarez said he really wanted to hire, but there's a lot of uncertainty with the rest of the coaching staff.
Yeah, and so oftentimes you hear coaches talking about players having to maintain focus. Well, this is a game where the coaches have to maintain focus. You need to get this job done so that you can get your next job done.
Melvin Gordon getting the job done here. That's a Wisconsin first down.
He's just taking advantage of excellent blocking up front. If you're going to look at that left offensive tackle, Haverstein, you're going to watch him. Does a nice job here. He's going to come outside. They're going to get Watt up inside. And all he's doing is patiently following his blocking. There's the one block. There's the second block. Really well done.
Left tackle Tyler Maritz was honorable mention all Big Ten. And Derek Watt, if the name sounds familiar, it should. His brother's here. He paved the way at fullback as well. And there's Gordon again following Watt and picking up about two. Chris Frost made the stop for Auburn.
Yeah,
and
Watt.
We've got another injury for Wisconsin.
Yeah, Watt is, of course, the younger brother of J.J. Watt, who will have a chance to be probably the MVP of the league. It'll be between him and Aaron Rodgers. But Watt is one of those guys that does everything right, makes very few mistakes, understands his role, knows the scheme, has good patience. In order to be a good blocker, you have to have running skills. You have to be able to see everything that Melvin Gordon is seeing behind you. And so when you have a good blocker, you also have a guy with good vision, and Watt's got that.
Quint Kesnick is down on the field, and Quint, that looks like the second team all Big Ten center Dan Volz shaken up on that last play.
Deja vu all over again for Wisconsin. Volts injured in that Ohio State Big Ten Championship loss. They'll have to swing Dallas Llewellyn from left guard to center. Ray Ball, number 71, will come in the game. And that radically changes this Wisconsin front. You know, it was interesting. I talked to another Big Ten coach about that Big Ten Championship. I said, 59-0. Did you see that coming? He said, well, the Volts injury is significant because when Llewellyn comes in and Ball, it changes two of the five positions. Volts is the chemistry guy. He's the voice. Tons and tons of starts. And that really had a huge impact in that game. Let's see how they handle it today.
Well, the entire starting offensive line regularly for Wisconsin was honored in terms of all Big Ten mentions. Havenstein at right tackle, first team all Big Ten. Kyle Costigan, right guard, first team all Big Ten. Volts, second team all Big Ten center. And even the left side, Llewellyn and Merritts, both honorable mention all Big Ten. And Barry Alvarez talked about, Matt, the kind of embarrassment of riches they've always had on the offensive line in Madison, but particularly with this group, they basically started the entire season together, and to then lose an all-conference center for the championship game, and now it looks like possibly for the bowl game. That's why he's got that look on his face.
Well, here's the piece that's not talked about. When you have Volts, he's your communication center. That center has to have great eyes. If you can't see, you can't play now as an offensive lineman. You're going to watch him. He's right here. Now, he's the guy who gets to the line of scrimmage and sees everything. And you can see he gets rolled up on right there, right on that side. Yeah, he's had trouble with that ankle, and it looks like he's going to have more trouble with it. But his vision translates to communication. And so he's the nerve center. He's the guy who calls to outside what your protections are, who we're moving to, where we're sliding to, who you're going to take care of, who you're not taking care of. And when he's absent, there's a communication and a language that's spoken that everybody knows. And here's the hard part. Volts, you get used to a voice when you're in a game. So there's 60,000 people. You have to be able to tune into that voice, and sometimes it's hard to do. Now, Llewellyn's back inside. They're going to have to adapt quick.
He's a fifth-year senior, so obviously he's also listening to Volts play in and play out. Now they go to a clap. Snap count, and down the sideline goes Melvin Gordon. If you let Melvin Gordon get to the edge, he will kill you. And Auburn lets him get outside for 29.
And the speedy Jonathan Ford is the guy who is able to run him down. And McAvoy is the safety slash quarterback who's in at the quarterback spot and allows him to be able to be respected enough in their running game that you have him hesitate just a tad to let Melvin Gordon get to the edge.
And we were told that Tanner McAvoy would have some plays running the read option, and here he is taking over at quarterback after the injury. This time, behind the line, it's Ladarius Owens that makes the stop on Corey Clement. That's a loss of about five. That should take us to the end, and does, to the end of the first quarter. And a good start. The Outback Bowl tight as could be, between Auburn and Wisconsin. Tied at seven here in Tampa. New year from all of us to all of you as well. The cheerleaders over on Clearwater Beach, part of the Outback Bowl experience for everyone from Auburn and Wisconsin. It's a great spot to come for a bowl game, and we had a very good first quarter. Bob Schusen, Matt Millen, Quinn Kesnick here at Raymond James Stadium, home of the Bucks. Second down and long to start the second quarter for Wisconsin. Stabby back in at quarterback, and he gives to Gordon using the stiff arm and muscles his way inside the 35. So it will be third down and long, third down and about eight coming for Wisconsin.
Now the good news for Wisconsin, as they get into third and long, he'll pick up his 6 or 7 yards here, but they put him in third and manageable because their offensive line has been doing a great job of protection for Stavi. And so they will need that here. I will be curious to see what kind of coverage they're going to play for Auburn, because they do not have a pass rusher. And right now, Wisconsin's defense on this offensive line is handling any kind of rush.
Five-man rush this time. Stavi up the seam too high. Intended for Sam Arneson. Now it's fourth down and eight at the 34-yard line. This is probably a bit too far to try a field goal of over 50 yards. Do you punt and try and pin Auburn deep?
Looks like that's the plan.
Well, this is the game management decision that we talked about with Barry Alvarez.
Right.
He was not going to be calling plays, developing the game plan. He left that to the coordinators, but these were the types of in-game decisions that he was going to be deciding on, and it is Drew Meyer out there to punt. This is a tough spot, a bitter pill to swallow to punt from when you're inside the opponent's 35-yard line.
Stavi let that ball come off a little bit too high.
And they'll take a delay here to give Meyer a little bit more room. Now, if you're Gus Malzahn, would you accept the penalty?
No, I'd decline it right here.
5-yard penalty, fourth down.
I would decline it. Make it harder for him to try to kick it in there.
Well, the penalty accepted, so that might give Drew Meyer an easier job to do to get it inside the 10-yard line. So much fun talking to Gus Malzahn, and we had several games this season with head coaches with a high school background.
Oh, yeah,
very
phenomenal.
Interesting to talk to Art Briles, Gus Malzahn, and some of the others in that category. The extra room helped to the 7-yard line. Drew Meyer gets the job done. The college football playoff makes history on ESPN today. Back-to-back semifinal games. Number 2, Oregon. Number 3, Florida State. Marcus Mariota and Jameis Winston square off at 5 o'clock in the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. And then at 8:30 Eastern, number 1, Alabama, number 4, Ohio State in the All-State Sugar Bowl. That's all later today, only on ESPN.
That
and that's going to be a fun matchup.
Is going to be really fun. Tell you what, don't count Jameis Winston out. The kid, pressure and big games don't beat him, don't matter to him. And Marcus Mariota, he's got the same kind of poise. That's going to be a fun one to watch.
Play action for Marshall from the end zone. He's going to go down at about the 2. Vince Beagle got there first for Wisconsin. Michael Caputo coming on a safety blitz as well.
Caputo is able to get there because there's coverage down the field. Nowhere to go with that ball. They had it doubled down the middle. You're going to watch him try to get down here to the slot. So the safety reads it perfectly. See, I was just going to try to get right down the middle, see the safety over the top. Nowhere to go with that ball. You have coverage back underneath here. Sets up the sack.
A loss of 4 on the sack back to the 3-yard line. Quick hitter, Sammy Coates. Buys a little bit of breathing room for the Tigers out to about the 9, so Jern Shelton made the stop. Still, it'll be 3rd down and about 8.
I would get Coates more involved right now. He's got speed and strength and a combination you don't find in college football. I would make them have to cover me.
Third down and a long 7. Auburn 2-for-4 so far.
Okay, safety's in the middle of the field. Colts all by himself on the outside. Now they put a safety over the top of him.
Marshall trying to avoid a sack. Somehow keeps his balance and almost threw an interception. Darius Hillary might have scored if he caught that airmailed ball from Nick Marshall.
I am really surprised that Wisconsin is getting the pressure that they're getting. They're giving you a lot of movement. That's what they do. They're not very big. So they're giving you a lot of movement with blitzes, and they're getting home. And part of it is because they do have, Schobert should have made that play. I mean, you got to find a way to get them on the ground. But they're having good coverage outside. They're doubling Coates, and everybody else is doing their job. That's a big series for them.
How about the strength of Nick Marshall to fight through the sack, and now Kenzel Doe slips and falls. Still great field position for Wisconsin. And that decision by Barry Alvarez to punt in plus territory
helped
pays
them.
Off.
Yep.
Auburn Auburn, Wisconsin, still tied at 7. Happy New Year from Tampa. Early second quarter, it's the Outback Bowl. Bob Wischusen and Matt Millen upstairs, and Quint Kesnick is downstairs. Q.
Both coaches spoke to us this week about the importance of attitude and focus. And so far this game, there's a huge contrast in emotion on this Wisconsin sideline, cheering every play. I mean, every single stop, every tackle, every yard gained is a big deal. Far side, Auburn sideline can't say the same. They seem a little flat right now.
Great field position for Wisconsin. And that's the first completion for Joel Stavi in his last four attempts, but only about a yard on the hitch to Alex Erickson. Trevon Reed came up and immediately made the tackle for Auburn.
Yeah, well done by Reed, but Jordan Frederick missed the block. Normally they're pretty good outside getting blocks down the field. And that's they do the little things well, this Wisconsin team. That's just well done there, making a miss and making the play.
Melvin Gordon to midfield. It'll be third down and about 4. And for Auburn, the first 5 FBS games they played this season, they didn't allow more than 21 points. Their last 6 games, they allowed at least 30 points in every game. Out, Ellis Johnson is the defensive coordinator. In comes Will Muschamp. And Gus Malzahn told us he feels like he's got the best defensive coach in football taking over next year.
Yeah, the funny thing was you're saying, how much is he going to be involved? And he said, well, he'll be in the booth. He won't really be doing much. And I said, that'll take about 5 minutes. No one will. He can't help himself.
Third down and 3. Melvin Gordon right up the gut. That's a first down. Chris Frost made the tackle, but not before Melvin Gordon picked up 6.
Yeah, he's just doing a really nice job of being. Watch how patient he is. See? And the hole presents itself right away. Ball comes across on a pull, and had he blocked Frost, he might still be running. Just good patience out of Melvin Gordon.
Now it's Clement lined up as the tailback. Clement close to another first down. Let's go down to Q.
Bob, Melvin Gordon missed a practice earlier this week with a fever, and it appears right now that Barry Alvarez and the coaching staff giving him some breaks early on in this ball game, knowing that they're going to need him in the fourth quarter. And so they're kind of giving him a little rest right now. Let him play himself into this game. We're seeing much more variety in the backfield with Clement.
Yeah, well, they're able to get variety because that offensive line's doing the job. Merritt, 61 on the left side, and then Ray Ball, that left guard, along with Llewellyn inside, they're getting it done.
Clement again, bouncing for another Wisconsin first down, and Corey Clement is closing in on 900 yards rushing for the season as the backup. So it's not like the two punch in that 1-2 punch is any slouch. He'll be the guy next season, and he already has shown that he can put up tremendous numbers closing in on a 900-yard season.
You know, we talked to Andy Ludwig, their offensive coordinator, and that's the first thing he talked. We talked about Melvin Gordon, but he said, hey, you just keep an eye on Clement. This kid's every bit as good a runner that we have on this team, which is high praise.
Play action for Stavi.
There it is.
It's tipped. Nice job in the flat by Derek Moncrief to get his hands on a pass that would have found its way to a wide open Kenzel Doe.
Yeah, that's on Stavi. You've got to be able, you have a throwing lane to get your eyes up right away. He's open now. By waiting just that little bit, it allows the defender to be able to get back underneath, and Moncrief gets his hand on the ball.
Tanner McAvoy now back in at quarterback on second down and 10 as Stavi comes to the sideline. McAvoy as a runner this year averaged close to 9 yards per carry. He'll throw here. Way over the head of Melvin Gordon. Now it's third down and 10, and there's a flag down in the Wisconsin backfield. Interesting decision here for Gus Malzahn. It's a holding penalty.
Holding. Offense, number 71. 10-yard penalty.
Replay second down.
And Gus Malzahn takes the real estate rather than the down. So now it's second down and 20.
Stavi's back in. If you had any consistency out of the quarterback position right now, Stavi started, what, 3 for 3 or 4 for 4? And now he's 5 out of 9. If he has any consistency, Wisconsin has at least another score here.
Melvin Gordon caught behind the line, extends the play, and loses more real estate because of it. What a hit by Robinson Therese as he buried Gordon along with some other Tigers all the way back near midfield.
Yeah, it was Therese that he saw bursting from that second level. Therese's 27, he's going to come off the left side of your screen after he makes the turn. And he is full bore. And it's because of that that play is made, because Gordon had a chance to bounce that thing.
Third down and 25 with Gordon on the sideline. As Wisconsin will just try and, you think, get in field goal range here if they could on this play.
You don't try to get it all, just get back underneath.
Stavi avoids a sack, throws one over the middle, that's intercepted. Trevon Reed with his third pick of the season.
Reed does a nice job of just staying in the hip pocket, and Stavi doesn't lead him well enough. He's able to find some time, but he throws that ball behind. This should have been a completion. Ball's thrown behind. Reed makes the pick. Said going into this thing, Auburn knew. They said, look, we're not letting Gordon get going. Make the quarterback beat you. That's what they said all week long, and that's what they're sticking to.
Corey Grant, maybe a yard. Again, it's Peniel Jean out on the edge making the stop for the Badgers.
He's a pretty good player, that Peniel Jean. He's a good tackler in space, and that's not easy to do. What he does well is he'll take the right angle from inside out. See how he did that? Inside out, he squared up, allowed him to get to the edge, and then burst from the inside. That's well done.
Looks like Gus Malzahn calls a timeout from the sideline.
Auburn.
This Wisconsin defense has them out of kilter a little bit here.
Midway through the second quarter. A lower scoring game than we expected. That has to play in Wisconsin's favor.
The 2015 Outback Bowl is brought to you by Franklin American Mortgage. It all begins with home. And Alka-Seltzer Plus cold and cough.
A week of fun riding the rides and heading to the beach in Clearwater for the cheerleaders, the teams, a cheerleader tug of war. Won by the Badgers. The Cheeseheads at least won on Clearwater Beach. We'll see what happens in the game.
You're the Piecker fan.
It's the Outback Bowl. Bob Wischusen alongside Matt Millen. Quint Kesnick down on the field. Midway through the second quarter, tied at 7 after the Auburn timeout. Nick Marshall looking deep. Ricardo Lewis behind the Badgers. Touchdown, Auburn.
Shelton let him get on top of him. It looked at the end that he was looking for the free safety, like, where were you? But Lewis just ran right by Shelton. Here's Lewis on the top side. He's going to just hit the seam. Watch. Beats him right at the start. Now it's a foot race. Safety's eyes are in the backfield. Never has a chance. And that was over fast.
Third touchdown this season for Ricardo Lewis, and that is his career-long play, 66-yard touchdown. And Auburn on top by a score with 8 minutes to go before halftime.
So the difference so far with 8 minutes to go in the second quarter is the play of the quarterback. It's exactly what both coaching staffs said it would be. And so you have to, they knew you're going to run the football. Gordon's had moderate success, and they're stacking the box against him. And so Wisconsin's done a pretty solid job defensively in slowing things down. The difference is the ability to make a big play down the field.
Does anything feel better if you're Gus Malzahn than you call that timeout from the sideline, and right out of the timeout you dial up a 66-yard touchdown that works to perfection?
Yeah, and Shelton, you know, Shelton had position to the outside. The free safety's eyes were still in the backfield when Lewis hit that second gear, and it was history. You got to know who can beat you at all times. When you're that middle guy, you cannot get beat deep. It is a cardinal sin.
And both Tiger touchdowns off of big-time field position. You get the pick, the short field, and also a bad punt back in the first quarter by Meyer. Gave Auburn field position near midfield. And both times, Nick Marshall takes the short field and puts Auburn in the end zone. Capital One Bowl Mania continues on Friday on ESPN. Houston and Pittsburgh in the Lockheed Martin Armed Forces Bowl at noon Eastern. And then Iowa takes on Tennessee in the Taxslayer Bowl from Jacksonville at 3:20 Eastern. And the trickle down from our game to the Houston-Pittsburgh game, of course. Paul Christ leaving Pitt, heading to Madison, back to his hometown. And there is the new Badger head coach watching this game from the stands rather than watching this game where he will watch all future Badger games, and that's putting a headset back on and patrolling the sideline.
That's a good coach. The thing you like about him, he's got some high school background in him as well, and he's a guy who knows whoever walks in that door, that's who you coach. And it doesn't matter how much you know, it matters how much your player knows. He gets that.
Jet sweep, Kenzel Doe, down the sideline. When Paul Christ was the offensive coordinator for the Badgers, their offense became, from a middle-of-the-road offense to when he left, one of the best in the country.
Yeah, and he knows how to coach the run game, and he knows how to integrate it in that play-action pass game. That's what he's really good at. He did it at Pitt the last couple years. Pitt got better each year. Well, he'll do the same thing here at Wisconsin.
Plus, he's a Madison guy.
Yeah.
He's a Wisconsin guy. He wants to be there. He wants to be the next Barry Alvarez. Wide receiver screen caught by Erickson. That's another first down for Wisconsin as we head down to Quint.
Bob, Christ is a coordinator and head coach who's really done his best work as a mentor of young quarterbacks, and that's an area when Wisconsin has great quarterback play, program goes through the roof. You're always going to get the good offensive linemen. The second thing would be he's going to bring back a staff to Madison, a lot of them who have been there before, who know the place, who know how to recruit in that part of the country. So it is a perfect fit from all indications.
After the head-scratching move, Gary Anderson to go from Madison to Oregon State. And that was a head-scratcher. Melvin Gordon for about four. Casanova McKenzie, second leading tackler for Auburn, made the stop.
The heck of a stop by McKenzie. If he doesn't make that, it's tough. You can see who's there. And Brett Bielema is doing a nice job down in Arkansas. They're going to be a good football team. Barry Alvarez went to the Rose Bowl, won three of them. Gary Anderson, it didn't look like it was a fit. This guy, Paul Christ, he's a fit. He's the right guy for the right school.
Gordon makes a man miss in the backfield and is about a yard and a half shy of a Wisconsin first down.
Yeah, this offensive line, they're doing it the right way right now. Andy Ludwig, the offensive coordinator, who incidentally is not going to be here next year. His game plan right now is to let his best players do their job. And their best players as a group is that offensive line in their matchup with that defensive front of Auburn. Let's see if they can get it done here on third and short.
They give it to Clement. Breaks a tackle. Second effort. About a half yard shy. Now what do you do if you're Barry Alvarez on fourth down and a yard, maybe a little less than a yard, at the Auburn 40?
This is a tough spot here. Me, you got to read the game. You might want to roll the dice here and let your offensive line win for you. You can't give it back to him because this is a critical time in the game for Flo. And it looks like he's going to go for it. I like this call by Alvarez.
You've got the number three rush offense in America, and you don't even need a full yard to pick up the first down.
Yeah, prove that you can do it.
It is Corey Clement. At tailback, he takes the handoff, and did he get shut down?
No.
Right at the first down marker, but that little extra surge got him past the line to make, and that is a fourth down conversion for the Badgers.
I think that's a great call by the CEO, Barry Alvarez. Let those guys come off the ball. And Clement, really, he gets stuck, and then he just keeps on moving. The difference in the play is Clement's drive.
Clement out, Melvin Gordon back in. What a 1-2 punch for Wisconsin. Play action for Stavi. To the sideline, sliding with a first down, catches Erickson out of bounds at the Auburn 21 in front of Jonathan Mincy.
Nice 17-yard gain. And Stavi does this perfectly because the route that's being run outside is a comeback to the sideline. And all you have to do is leverage the defender. See how he got him on his inside hip? Then you just run away. And so if you have any kind of accuracy, this is a completion. Stavi did a nice job.
Melvin Gordon. Hit by Chris Frost right at the line of scrimmage. So the ninth play of the drive brings up second down and 10. With 4 minutes to go in the half.
You know, Casanova McKenzie and Chris Frost, the two linebackers, number 8 and number 17, those guys have made a lot of tackles this year. And if you're going, and they're aggressive. And so one of the areas that you'd like to do if you're going to play against those two inside is play action. Because they are so aggressive, you want them to bite up inside and need to try to get one of those tight ends in behind them. I haven't seen that here yet.
Play clock down to 5. Stavi. Tipped ball down to the 5-yard line. That's an interception. The 21st this season for Auburn. Jermaine Whitehead off the carom has it fall right into his hands at the 5-yard line.
Erickson should have had that pass. It was in his hands. It would have been a tough catch, but a catch you have to make.
5 interceptions on the season now for Jermaine Whitehead. No team in the SEC picked off more balls this year than Auburn, and they now have 2 here in the first half. Jermaine Whitehead makes another big play for the Auburn defense. 14-7, Auburn has the lead in the Outback Bowl, a pick at the 5-yard line.
Yeah, here's Whitehead back here. This is good discipline on the front end. Frost is going to drop to middle. They're going to have one low, one high. So here's how you attack it. You get to the seam and you hold him. You leverage this player. This is the right read and the right throw. And right there, he screwed it up by not catching it. He hit him in the hands, and it was the wrong place, apparently. That was the right read and the right place to go with the ball. And that's just sometimes it bees like that.
Yeah, sometimes it goes against the quarterback on the stat column, but it's on the receiver. And that time, the drop by Erickson, a big break for Auburn. Marshall breaks a tackle, turns the corner, and he turned nothing into something. Picked up 5. He could have easily been brought down at the 1-yard line. Again, Joe Schobert had a chance to drop him for a loss, couldn't do it.
Yeah, watch the strength with the hand. He's going to give a stiff arm, and then the speed, the acceleration from here. And that's why Nick Marshall is going to play at the next level. And let me tell you something. Nick Marshall is going to be a quarterback at the next level. He'll be a number 3, and then he'll be an athlete. He'll be a receiver. He can be a defender. He played corner. He's got it, and he'll be an asset to any team that takes him.
Cameron Artis Payne grinds out a first down. He's been quiet here in the first half. That's only his 8th carry for 32 yards.
Yeah, but if I'm Auburn right now calling the plays, I'm Gus Malzahn or Rhett Lashley, that's what I'm going to do. I'm running the football, and I'm establishing that. Let him get moving.
To the 20-yard line goes Artis Payne.
Shoes, one of the things when you watch this Auburn team, they have some really strong tendencies. You can get them by formation and by field position and down and distance, and they show up strong. Like, we just watched four games, and we could see them. If we broke them down, they would jump off the page. So knowing what they're doing is an asset if you're playing them, if you have the team who's able to recall that. And that was one of the things that Dave Aranda, the defensive coordinator for Wisconsin, thought that was one of the things that they could do. You can see them, they're identifying things right away.
Marshall floats one to the sideline, and that is well defended by Caputa.
That Caputa, he's been all over the place. He's very active as a safety. He comes down fast. And by that I mean when he reads the run, he's at the line of scrimmage very fast. But he also has pass skills, coverage skills, and none better than what you saw right there.
Looked like Frank Kaminsky guarding the rim. Third down and 8 with 1:52 to go in the half. Here comes a Wisconsin blitz. Marshall is able to beat the blitz, but Quan Bray drops the football.
Yeah.
So both quarterbacks with a big drop, drastically affecting how the rest of this half could play out.
Yeah, this is Nick Marshall. This ball's exactly where it's supposed to be. They come out of a stack, and so it's defined quickly. You see, the first guy takes his man outside. That leaves you one-on-one in space. Sheldon wasn't able to get there. He was leveraged. The ball was there. Incomplete.
So Joel Stavi and Nick Marshall both should have had big completions in this last sequence, both victimized by drops. Carlson, pretty good punt. Enzel Doe returnable from the 40.
Oh! It's blown up.
Robinson Therese, an impact play now on special teams with 1:40 to go in the half.
He has a habit of running into people, doesn't he?
I like how Millen likes that.
That's great.
Welcome back to New Orleans, everyone. I'm John Saunders. Coming up on our halftime report, TCU was left out along with Baylor. TCU was impressive. Can Baylor match that as well as they face Michigan State? Here in New Orleans, it's the All-State Sugar Bowl, and this one promises to be a classic between Alabama and Ohio State, and then, of course, the other semifinal in the Rose Bowl. Oregon and Florida State will match them all. Look at all those games ahead coming up on our halftime report, guys.
All right, John, thanks very much. They're on the Gus Bus here at the Outback Bowl.
The team Bloomin' Onion,
which is now captained by Matt Millen. This is like the Bloomin' Onion, isn't it? This
oh,
is
yeah.
The appetizer. Now, John mentioned what the main course is going to be, and that's the college football playoff coming up later on. Pasadena followed by New Orleans as we make history beginning at 5 o'clock on ESPN. Wisconsin has all of their timeouts in good field position. Stavi to Jordan Frederick. A yard shy of a first down.
Frederick's done a nice job here in the first half of blocking on those little screens.
Brought down by Jonathan Vinci. Second and 1 at the 49.
Blitz coming. Stavi well protected, so he goes up the seam, almost throws another interception with a flag down. Arneson, the intended receiver, Robinson Therese, sag back in coverage, and it's going to be against the Tigers.
Yeah, he was beat. Yeah, Arneson had him. He threw it behind him again. It's a second throw
holding
like that.
Defense, number 27, 10-yard penalty from the previous spot, automatic, first down.
Therese doesn't like the call. Arneson had him leveraged. By that I mean you get him to his side. See how he has him to the right? He had him on his shoulders. But that ball is thrown completely behind him.
Quick slant. A little too low for Kenzel Doe.
That should have been caught.
Kenzel Doe's only 5'8", so you really have to throw it low for Kenzel Doe not to be able to scoop it up.
You had to throw it low for Kenzel Doe.
Keep going with that.
I'm running out of this.
Second down and 10. And Wisconsin, remember, won the toss and deferred. So they'll start the third quarter with the football. They have a chance to string together back-to-back possessions here. But they're across the 50-yard line again. Both of the interceptions thrown by Stavi have been in plus territory.
He's got a nice matchup on the safety with Arneson.
Five-man rush. Stavi rolls right into the pressure. Somehow keeps the play alive and eventually goes down. It was Gabe Wright that was all over Stavi. And now Stavi is flat on his back after the hit. The clock winding down as well.
This is about coverage. There's time to be able to throw. And now Wright comes off that edge, beats Castigan. That was good coverage down the field.
And a mistake here, I think, by Gus Malzahn, maybe not calling a timeout. I
agree with you.
Down to 30 seconds to go on the half, and this is obviously the decision from the Wisconsin sideline to play for halftime. They've let the clock wind down as far as they can. Hand off to Gordon. He gets to midfield. And now Gus Malzahn will call a timeout, but there's only 17 seconds to go on the half.
Yeah, and you're going to have the punt in here and a change of possession, and you wasted about a good 30 seconds.
Well, the one thing that the Gus Malzahn timeout does is it forces Wisconsin to punt. If Auburn doesn't call a timeout, your Wisconsin probably let the clock wind all the way down and then throw a Hail Mary into the end zone on the last play, but now you can't do that, as if the Hail Mary's incomplete, Auburn would get the ball at midfield.
Yeah, but if you go back and add that 30 seconds back in and you take your timeout there.
No question.
Now you have the opportunity because they're third and 29. They're not going to get the first. Then you take your timeout and then you have something to work with on the other side. A more competitive first half than a lot of people thought it would be.
Quandre is dangerous if he gets an opportunity. But you can't imagine that Drew Meyer will kick it anywhere near him.
Then again, maybe not.
Down to 11 seconds to go in the half. And Nick Marshall, he's made some plays, the last of which was a 66-yard touchdown over the top to give Auburn the lead.
Well, he's been throwing the underneath ball. They've kept him on the run. He'll beat you with his feet. And he's been accurate with the ball. But the big killer was the one down the field. You gave him a lot of time. And this is what they love to do. They love to break a defense by getting somebody over the top of the coverage. Nick Marshall is as advertised. And I mentioned it earlier, and I'll say it again. He will play at the next level. He will be a quarterback. He might be a three, but he'll get playing time at other positions. The kid's a good athlete and a very good football player.
So it's a touchdown lead for Auburn at halftime. Wisconsin will start the third quarter with the football, but they trail after scoring on their opening possession. 14 unanswered for Gus Malzahn's team, and he's on the field with Quint.
Coach, what's the biggest challenge their defense is presenting you?
Well, first of all, they're pretty good, but they're kind of going odd to even. They're giving some different looks. They're doing a good job of mixing things up.
What happened on the Ricardo Lewis deep ball for the touchdown?
Yeah, hey, it was just a well-executed play. Ran by him. Nick made a very good throw.
They've marched into your territory a number of times. What's made the difference for your defense?
Yeah, our defense has really bowed their back there when it gets down here and made some big plays, kept them out of the end zone.
Thank you, Coach.
Two takeaways by Gus Malzahn's defense. A couple of the biggest plays in the first half. And our halftime score, Auburn on top of Wisconsin, 14-7. We'll head to John Saunders in New Orleans. Our live halftime report from the All-State Sugar Bowl coming up right after these messages. Welcome back to ESPN's coverage of the 2015 Outback Bowl here at Raymond James Stadium in Tampa, all part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Melvin Gordon getting set for the second half. And we're just about set for the start of the third quarter. A touchdown separates Auburn and Wisconsin. Auburn has the lead. Low scoring game. You'd think this is probably more the score that Wisconsin was looking for, in spite of the fact that they're down a touchdown. Their defense has kept them in it.
Yeah, and you heard Gus Malzahn talking to Quinn Kesnick at the end of the half, saying, you know, give him a couple different looks. And that's been effective for this Wisconsin team, because what they've done is they've taken their safety, Caputo, and they've used him, and you have to either account for him or not account for him. In this particular case, you're going to see Caputo down, and they have what they're calling is an odd front, which has been a switch for them. Always a man on the nose, and then a three down, four man look. Caputo becomes the guy. Who do you count for? In this particular case, everybody's back inside, and they're playing good, stout front. So now they'll give you another look. It's still that same 30-odd look, okay? He'll reduce that in. And now you got Caputo outside. Do you count for him inside, or do you not account for him? In this particular case, they're going to bring him, and it's effective again. He's able to stymie Nick Marshall and have him step up, and the net result is another sack. So the last thing they do is they go with two, okay? So now you got just two down guys, same personnel groups. And so they'll give you a completely different look. Again, they're going to make you have to account for people in the box on the inside. Who do you count and who do you not count? And this time again, they're going to bring pressure, and the net result is to force Nick Marshall out of the pocket. So they're giving them different look shoes. They make you account for different personnel groups and lined up in different spots. And so far, that's been effective for this Wisconsin defense.
That's Matt Millen. I'm Bob Wischusen. Quinn Kesnick down on the field. Cameron Artis Payne and the Tiger offense, they put two touchdowns up. Wisconsin did outgain Auburn 218 yards to 177 in the first half, but the two interceptions thrown by Joel Stavi, both in plus territory, both arguably taking points off the board for the Badgers, and now they start the third quarter with the ball.
They went into this game saying Stavi will be the guy. He'll be the determinator whether or not they have a productive day or a non-productive day. And thus far, they've been right. Stavi has to be consistent, Shoes.
Ugly but effective. It is a touchback, and Quinn Kesnick's down on the field.
Finishing drives is the biggest challenge we face. The words of Barry Alvarez, interim head coach of Wisconsin. Two critical personnel notes. Dan Volz, the center, done for the day with that ankle injury. And you're going to see more of safety Tanner McAvoy, 6'6". We've seen him play both sides of the ball today, quarterback and safety. He's in there more as a center fielder with his great height to defend against the deep ball. Otherwise, Wisconsin looks fresh as a daisy, so to speak, Bob. I don't think the Auburn tempo has gotten to this defense quite yet.
Well, their offense has done a good job of keeping the defense on the bench at times. And now they start with a toss to Melvin Gordon. There he goes. Gordon down the sideline. Good start to the second half for the Badgers. A gain of 17 and a first down.
Nothing happens for Melvin Gordon on the edge if they don't A, block the edge and get help out of their receivers down the field. And this is just another nice job of blocking down the field with Jordan Frederick. He did it in the first half, and he's doing it again here for the start of the second.
Melvin Gordon already with his 12th 100 rushing game of the season.
That was a quiet 100, wasn't it?
22nd time in his career he's gone over 100 as well. Here he goes again, right up the gut. He is a wonderful blend of speed and power. He gets hit, still gains an extra 3 or 4 yards after contact.
That's a great observation, Bob, because I don't think people put him in the power category. But you saw how he finishes that run. Watch him finish this run. From contact, boom, right there, he's still going. That's another 3 yards after contact with four guys on him. He runs behind his pads. It's a great trait.
Gordon again. First down, Wisconsin. So now you start to wonder, for this Wisconsin offense, can they do what Barry Alvarez talked to Quinn Kesnick about? Twice in the first half, they got to plus territory and turned it over. Another time, they were inside the 35-yard line and punted. It's about finishing drives and putting points on the board. They've been in plus territory a lot to only have 7 points up.
Well, right now, with Llewellyn in at the center spot, and Ray Ball at that left guard spot, Now, they already went through this one time. They look like they're on all cylinders right here.
End around. George rushing. Gets to the edge. That's another Wisconsin first down inside the Auburn 30.
Very well blocked on the interior and on the edge. Another good job of blocking down the field by the receivers. That's this really well done by Arneson. You see him leading the way, but you see Trailer 46. He had a key block to be able to get that. Here's Arneson clearing the way. That's just good blocking down the field, good team football.
Clement again. Grinds out about four more.
It seemingly looks like there's nothing there. And now you've heard me speak about runner's patience. Okay, some guys have it in spades. Clement's got it. Melvin Gordon has it. And so from the end zone, look, the inclination is to hurry up and get to Watt, okay? But the good runners slow themselves down and allow the blockers to complete their blocks. Not just get into them, but finish them. And that gives you that extra push.
Six straight runs to start off the second half for Wisconsin. And Melvin Gordon makes it a touchdown on run number six.
It's that patience again. There it is. Allow your guys to do the job. And once you see the crack, your ability to accelerate. That's what Melvin Gordon brings that few can. See the patience slow down? Now see the crack? Hit it. That is really well done.
We're tied at 14. The 27th rushing touchdown this season for Melvin Gordon.
All Melvin Gordon. That's what they needed. That's what they got.
Bob Beshoes and Matt Millen, Quinn Kesnick at the Outback Bowl. We're now tied at 14, and Matt takes us back to the Melvin Gordon touchdown.
Yeah, this is really fun. I want to show you some what you call runner's patience. It all starts, obviously, with the runner, but then you have to be patient to allow your fullback to make the block. And then this guard, see how he's pulled? He's sitting back off the ball. That's an indicator he's going to pull. Arneson is the third piece of the puzzle. Watch him wash it down. Okay, there's one. Here's your second block. That's Watt. That's very well done. Here's your patience. Slow it down and allow Kaskin to be able to make that block. Once you see that, here's your vision, and then here's the crease. You have to accelerate to hit that crease. He has all of it in spades, and runner's patience can't look any better than what Melvin Gordon showed you there.
The runner-up for the Heisman, the Doak Walker Award winner, caps an opening second-half touchdown drive. The first points that Wisconsin has put on the board since their opening drive of the game. So they open both halves with touchdowns, and we are now tied at 14.
Shoes, they're big on the running game right now. 31 rushes, 216 yards. That's a 7-yard average for Wisconsin.
Corey Grant takes a knee. So now we'll see if Auburn can answer, as Nick Marshall had that 66-yard touchdown pass over the top to give Auburn the lead. And at halftime, Wisconsin down by a touchdown. They come right out of the locker room, march right down the field. This is a good one.
Yeah, that was a huge drive for them. That they needed the confidence. They went in at halftime, made their adjustments, said this is what we need to do, and then they went out in the third quarter and did just that.
And now you wonder if Cameron Artis Payne gets his back up a little bit. Because if he looks up at that statistical scroll on the scoreboard, he sees Melvin Gordon with 143 yards. And so far, he's got 34. Make it 33. Brought down behind the line by Vince Beagle.
Beagle is a guy that, for this Wisconsin, that has really good quickness. Okay, again, here's another look. Remember we talked about it? At halftime, this time they went with two down linemen and they brought Beagle off the edge. They have the same setup right now. Two down people and then Everybody else is standing, so you have to be able to decide who you're going to pick to block. It's very fluid.
Screen to Artis Payne. And he gets some blocks. First down, Auburn, out to the 42. A gain of 18.
That's the part of Artis Payne's game that you haven't really seen a lot. He doesn't have a lot of catches, but he has good hands. And he's good in the open field. The one piece you'd like to see from him is to have that Melvin Gordon breakaway speed.
4 yards right up the middle. Marcus Trotter was first there for Wisconsin on the tackle.
Tell you, the kid who's been actually played a very good game is number 45, Herring. He's the only guy really who has any kind of size in there. He and Goldberg have some size, but he's been the guy who's been the nose. He's been the guy who's had to cover up the guard, and his job really is to define your point of attack. Not a glorious job, but one that he's doing very well right now.
One injury we haven't spent any time talking about, Konrad Zagzebski, the normal nose tackle, a knee injury carted off against Ohio State. He's out. Here's Ricardo Lewis on the end around. Hurdles a man out of bounds at the 39-yard line. Sojourn Shilton went low. Ricardo Lewis went high, and he picks up about 17.
Yeah, usually after this is when they give you a lot of different motion and movement inside.
Artis Payne for 2.5. Michael Caputo on the tackle.
That's a big tackle there by Caputo. There was no one there. Caputo was the last line of defense.
Nick Marshall set to go quickly. Again, it's Artis Payne. And now it's third down and about 5, maybe 6 for Auburn to try and keep the drive alive.
They're going with pace here. Two Artis Payne runs inside. Now they've slowed it down because they're going to make some substitutions. Keep in mind, when they make a substitution, you have to allow the defense to make it. Wisconsin chooses not to.
Third down and a long 5. And it's still Sammy Coates getting sparse playing time over on the sideline for Auburn. There comes a blitz. A pump fake. Nick Marshall. Wobbly ball down the sideline. Quan Bray gets tied up with Shilton. No flag comes out. And now it's 4th down and 5. This is either a long field goal attempt or perhaps Auburn goes for it.
I would go for it if I was them. I think I'm surprised he took that shot. Now they're going to kick it.
It'll be in the neighborhood of a 50, maybe a 51-yard field goal attempt for Daniel Carlson, and this would be his long this season.
Wisconsin has done a great job of mixing things up defensively and giving them different looks. And the Auburn offensive line has not found its rhythm.
Looked like Wisconsin's guarding against a possible fake. This from 51. It's got the leg. Good. Daniel Carlson's previous long was 46. He's good from 51, and that gives Auburn the lead. So Gus Malzahn shows faith in his redshirt freshman kicker. That would have been good from 60. Melvin Gordon was asked, could you put up the same numbers in the SEC that you put up in the Big Ten? And his response was, well, I went for 140 on LSU. You call it what you want. I can't help it if I'm in the Big Ten. I feel like I can do this in whatever conference. And Matt Millen, he's proving that point so far today.
Oh, he's feeling it, isn't he? You know, he's looking at a 200-yard game right now. And if you look at where he's getting it all over the field. But the one that's impressive is right up inside. Why is that impressive? Because you're running at the heart of that Auburn defense, and you're running it without probably your best offensive lineman, with Volts out. And so he's shown well to date. Let's see what he can do.
No chance for Kenzel Doe on the return. And the NFL playoffs start on ESPN. And it starts Saturday at 4:20 Eastern. Cam Newton and the NFC South champion Panthers have won 4 in a row. Now they host Larry Fitzgerald and the Cardinals. It's now win or go home for two NFC teams trying to prove they belong. the NFL playoffs wild card round. Cardinals, Panthers, Saturday at 4:20 Eastern on ESPN.
You know, both those teams, their kind of mojo's going in different ways. As Arizona's had some injuries, they've kind of fallen off a little bit. While on the other side, Carolina's picked up the pace a little bit, and they're starting to come on. One thing I'm going to tell you, though, for sure, last year they didn't have a running back taken in the first round for two straight years. That ends this year.
There's another running back. There's the heir apparent again on the jet sweep. It's Corey Clement, and that's another first down on the ground for Wisconsin. That's a gain of 14 more.
This is exactly what Wisconsin wanted to do. If we run the football, if we ground the ball, their offense doesn't have it. We can keep away from them. And that's what they've been doing. And this, whatever adjustment they made here in the second half, whether it was just a kick in the rear end to pick it up because you know you can do it, both these running backs are running extremely well, which is a credit to this team blocking.
Their roommates, Clement and Gordon, combining for 213 yards so far. Wide receiver screen with a flag down. A gain of 7. It looked as if it may have been Auburn in the neutral zone at the snap. I'll have to check the penalty.
I think you're right.
Offside. Defense, number 50, in the neutral zone at the snap. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay first down.
So Barry Alvarez accepts the penalty. Rather than second and 3, it will be first and 5.
Well, the way they're running the football right now and taking advantage of that down group of Auburn, which really surprises me. Look, like that Wright kid's a good player. He's got some game to him. Blackson's also a pretty good player.
The toss to Gordon. This time Auburn does a good job to string him out. Big hit, and that'll be a flag. Melvin Gordon went sailing into the trainer's table. Casanova McKenzie's going to cost his team 15. And now tempers start to flare on the sideline. Chris Frost getting into an argument, maybe with Barry Alvarez. Looked like Barry Alvarez is about 5 yards out on the field with something to say.
Well, remember what he said. Remember what he said at the beginning of the game to Q, just like the old days. Yeah. Melvin Gordon was able to get out of a loss with his
after
speed.
The play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, late hit out of bounds, defense, number 9. The 15-yard penalty will be added to the dead ball spot, first down.
Well, you're going to watch this one all the way through. And the problem is he's talking about number 8, not number 9. And what he's talking about, you start your hitting motion inbounds, it's really hard to draw the line. Once you're in the motion, it's tough.
Play action for Stavi. Pass protection was there again. And he's got Troy Fumagalli, the tight end, on a check down.
Yeah, this Auburn defense has not had a pass rusher really all season long. The times that they've been able to generate it has been with blitzing. And so right now, unless you're going to start run blitzing and taking chances on the outside, which I believe they can do because they can run with the receivers and they don't really have a running quarterback. So I would still continue to crowd this line of scrimmage but defend the edges.
Another play action fake. Stavi buys time, floats one up the seam, jump ball for Arneson, intercepted at the 5-yard line. A bad decision by Stavi, but a flag down in the offensive backfield. If the play stands, that's interception number 2 for Jermaine Whitehead.
I would put the ball in the hands of Melvin Gordon, and that's it.
Holding, offense, number 46. That penalty's declined, result of the play, interception, first down.
The third interception. All in plus territory for Auburn, second by Whitehead, both at the 5-yard line.
Well, all I can tell you is that's an awful throw. That's all you can say. And he had plenty, he had time. It's just, that's... Good job by Whitehead of playing the center field and then going getting that balloon.
I'm not sure if we'd like to read the cartoon balloon coming out of the head of Barry Alvarez as he looked displeased. Nick Marshall back to work from his goal line. The second time that Whitehead has picked off Stavi at the five. Artis Payne gets outside. Flag down. This could be coming back.
Well, the good news, it'll only be a 2.5-yard penalty.
Personal foul, face mask, offense, number 72. Half the distance to the goal from the previous spot. Replay first down.
That's Sean Coleman, the left tackle. And you hate to bring it up when Coleman commits a penalty, but he is one of the best stories, not just in this game, but in college football.
Absolutely.
He is a leukemia survivor. Diagnosed after signing with Auburn back in 2010, underwent treatment in 2011 at St. Jude's in Memphis, enrolled and really finally got on the field for the first time full-time this year. And he's out there blocking for Artis Payne. Forget the penalty. Artis Payne's all the way out to the 21-yard line with a first down. Tanner McAvoy, the quarterback playing safety, made the stop.
I like Cameron Artis Payne. I'm telling you, he grows on you. The more you watch him, the better he becomes. Why? Because he's not real flashy. But here's the patience again. Let things happen now. Run through tackles. That should have been a 3-yard gain. Instead, he runs right through the tackle.
Wide receiver screen to Quan Bray. Breaking more tackles and picking up another first down. Again, it's Tanner McAvoy out there to force Bray out of bounds.
This Auburn offense feeds off this type of thing. You get this thing, now you start to get pace and tempo going.
And maybe the pace a little too quick for the Tigers. It's a false start.
Proud of the snap. False start. Offense, number 51. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Shoes, you see what happened? So Wisconsin lined up in a 34 front. And right before they went quickly, they shifted, and that made Auburn jump.
It's a reverse to Bray. But Wisconsin was waiting. It's only a pickup of about 6. It'll be second down and close to 10. And let's go down to Quint.
The pace has not been to Coach Gus Malzahn's liking. He'd like to see it go faster, especially when they start having success. This is a team that gets in rhythm, and look out when they start, you know, clicking on first down and getting chunk yardage on first down. Right here, they had to make a sub, so they got to go slow.
Yeah, and they beat themselves, Q. You know, with that penalty, it just slows everything down, kind of puts a little hitch in their get along.
Marshall, well protected. Now the pocket starts to break down, and he escapes. There goes Nick Marshall. First down, close to midfield. You know, Matt, the last time we saw this Auburn offense, they were racking up yards, 505 total yards in the Iron Bowl for Nick Marshall alone against Alabama's defense.
Interestingly, when this Wisconsin staff went back to say, who can we play like, they said Kansas State.
Really?
Kansas State was the team that they thought that they could emulate, not because they have the horses, but because they had to play the tendencies and the mental game so well. They believe they have a smart group of kids, and that was one of the things you put up there as an asset, and so far it's been working.
How true to the tendencies does Auburn's offense stay once you watch them on tape?
Very, very strong tendencies.
So it's not like Gus Malzahn is trying to necessarily hide what's coming. They line up, and what you've seen on tape formationally usually predicts what you're about to see.
Exactly right.
Here's play action for Marshall. Bullets one to Quan Bray. Inside the 30-yard line. That's another first down for Auburn.
Peniel Jean is mad at himself. He had the read, and he hesitated.
Here's the tempo. It's Marshall on a keeper. Nick Marshall uses the stiff arm. Tanner McAvoy makes another stop at the Badger 27.
Yeah, Peniel Jean's going to be on the inside of that safety spot, and he has the right read on it. He just got a slow break on it. You're going to see him get mad at the end. He knew he had that. He just couldn't line it up. Bray has been money here today. And who hasn't been money has been Coates, who really has been in and out of the lineup.
He's
less out than in.
Largely invisible. And this, of course, is an Auburn offense without Duke Williams. Suspended for the bowl game. A tipped ball and an interception dropped for Wisconsin. Michael Caputo tipped it. It was right in the hands of Sojourn Shelton, and he drops what was a room service interception. What a dodge bullet for the Tigers.
Yeah, ding dong, room service, and his own teammate is the one who defends it.
Marcus,
that was Marcus Trotter.
Trotter. It's a heck of a pass defense. The only problem was your receiver.
Exactly.
Would have maybe taken it the other way.
It's a big down right here for both teams. Auburn needs to step on the pedal a little bit. And Wisconsin, they've got to prevent a score.
They're going to have to call timeout. They're still in the huddle with two on the play clock.
Auburn takes its first timeout of the half.
So Gus Malzahn calls a timeout from the sideline. And that whole Auburn off playoff kicks off later today on ESPN with back-to-back semifinals. The matchups we've all been waiting to see. Number 2, Oregon. Number 3, Florida State at 5 Eastern in the Rose Bowl game. Presented by Northwestern Mutual. The winner moves on to Arlington to meet the winner of the All-State Sugar Bowl. At 8:30 Eastern, they'll kick it off at the Superdome between Alabama and Ohio State. That's all later today only on ESPN.
I'm really anxious to watch how Cardale Jones plays, because all they really have had to go was off of one game. And they got on a roll, and they beat this Wisconsin team soundly early and not a lot of pressure. It'll be different against that Alabama defense.
Big play after the timeout. Sammy Coates is on the field. Third down and 8 for Auburn.
His feet, that's the wild card.
Up the seam, incomplete. Nick Marshall tried to find Melvin Ray, and now it is fourth down and 8. Not long ago, Daniel Carson kicked one from 51. So this is obviously inside field goal range.
That one's on Nick Marshall. Ray had him leveraged. There was nobody. He had the inside completely free. That ball needs to be thrown back down low inside. See how he has him? The defender on his hip. Everything to the inside is free. Throw it down inside.
Carlson from 44. This one's just outside the upright. So one of the first times today where Auburn has gone into Wisconsin territory and not gotten points.
Looks like he pushed it just a little bit. And trust me, I could never figure out kickers anyway. Barry Alvarez is happy with the outcome. Let's see if he can get back with his offense to running the football. Right now, there's two guys I'm handing that ball to. Melvin Gordon and Corey Clement, and that's it.
There's Gordon. Dragged backwards after a gain of 9.
You know, I saw a number of scouts here today. And every one of them said the same thing. They said, boy, this 25 is pretty good, isn't he? And they've already done their homework. They know where they have him. A lot of times now you're seeing GMs and other guys, they want to see him in person. They want to see, because there's a difference between tape and then watching a guy live. You see the size, you see his quickness, you see all that thing, all those things, and it just kind of makes it come alive for you.
Moves for a Wisconsin first down. The ball pops out late, but sounded like we had already blown a whistle on the field before the ball came out.
Yeah, you see the far official had already started motioning and stuck
his progress was stopped prior to the ball coming out. Third down.
First down.
He was beyond the line to gain, so that is a first down for Wisconsin.
First down.
Yeah, you're going to see it. He's already down.
First down.
this official right on the top of your screen as he was walking in had already blown it.
Only a yard on first down this time from Melvin Gordon. Good job up front by Trey Williams, true freshman from Mobile, who came in to make the tackle.
Yeah, and very aggressive by Trey Williams. And so, you know, I don't want to kill the guy, but right now, if Stave had any confidence right now, you would go play action. Now is the time. They are streaming to the ball inside. Look how tight they are to the line of scrimmage. Play action this thing.
Instead, it's a handoff to Clement. Drives for about three more yards. Casanova McKenzie on the stop for the Tigers. So this brings up a big third down. Third and five as we're inside of 2 minutes to go in the third quarter.
Yeah, big Ray Ball, the guard, number 71, he got up in kind of a lot of pain. And he's holding that left shoulder, left arm. But he's just sucking it up and he's going right back in. Big third down here.
Stavi sets up the screen to Clement. The Tigers not fooled. But somehow he drags a tackler close to the first down. He's about a yard shy. Now, how confident is Barry Alvarez in the run game for the Badgers to maybe go for it on fourth and one from Wisconsin's side of the 50?
Wow, I would say no here, but
oh, here, man, comes Melvin Gordon.
He's rolling the dice. He is rolling the dice. They're saying, look, our offensive line is better than your defensive line. We're going to go get it. Let's see if he doesn't try to have him jump here with a hard count.
Fourth and one. Play clock at nine. They're going to run the play. It's Gordon. He's got the first down and more. Makes a move. Melvin Gordon inside the 20. Uses the stiff arm. Pylon. Is he in? It's a Wisconsin touchdown.
I guess Barry Alvarez was feeling pretty good about his running back, Gordon, who told us yesterday he's the best running back Wisconsin's ever had. That's some high praise. They're checking to see if he's in all the way in the replay.
The ruling on the field was touchdown. The previous play is under further review.
That's Mike DeFee, our referee, out of the Big 12. So they're going to go to the replay booth to see if indeed Melvin Gordon got inside the pylon or if he stepped out inside the five. Either way, it's a huge play for Wisconsin as they go for it on fourth and one. And the ruling on the field is Melvin Gordon took it to the house.
You see what he did to Whitehead, man? He froze him. He froze him and then got away from it. We'll have to get right down in the bottom. Oh, he stepped right on the pylon. That's going to be six. That is a phenomenal effort. You saw, again, the runner's patience to start and then vision. And then watch him finish. He refuses to quit. Whitehead's trying to push him. His foot, it comes down on the goal line, and then the other one hits the pylon. Hey, this is a good job by these two officials right here. Watch this official. His eyes are right there where it's supposed to be. The other official is trailing, and his eyes are on the bottom.
Further review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. Yeah. Touchdown.
That was great officiating. Good mechanics, the way it's supposed to be. And they didn't signal right away. They checked with each other, each one saying, yes, mine was good, yes, mine was good, and then they gave the signal.
So Wisconsin now has the team record for most rushing yards ever in the Outback Bowl. In 1995, the Badgers, and then in 1998, Michigan, both ran for 278 yards in the Outback Bowl. We're not officially through three quarters yet And Wisconsin has run for 299 yards. And this one on fourth down and one.
Watch the patience first. Now the vision back inside. He freezes Whitehead. And now watch the speed and the fight at the end. That is, that's a phenomenal play. Watch him shake it. Oh, that was great. Good job by Whitehead to not give up on it. It's just that Gordon just fights him to the end.
Barry Alvarez was the one that makes the decision as to whether or not to go for it on fourth and one. It's fun when the decision pays off.
I know he loves this.
Well, keep in mind as well, Wisconsin has been in plus territory five times in this game where they haven't gotten points.
Right.
They punted in plus territory twice, and all three Joel Stavi interceptions were thrown not only inside the 35-yard line, one of them twice. Jermaine Whitehead picked off Stavi at the five. So Melvin Gordon's closing in on an individual Outback Bowl rushing record, and he's the reason, and maybe the biggest reason, why Wisconsin has the lead in a game where they have had plenty of opportunities to put points on the board on top of the 21 that they've scored and have not. Corey Grant, a delayed decision, brings it out and gets hit hard at the 19-yard line. Let's go down to Quint.
He's hurt.
When Gary Anderson left for Oregon State and Barry Alvarez was contemplating taking this interim head coaching spot, he called his grandson, who's a member of this Wisconsin Badger team, to get clearance, to find out if it would, how it would resonate and if would it be okay. Grandson said, "Grandpa, it'll be great to have someone on the sideline with swag." And I think you saw that swagger on that fourth and one.
And that's 36. You could see Joe Ferguson just... Hudson was brought over to the sideline, shaken up on that play. Ferguson is the grandson of Barry Alvarez on this team. And he liked the idea, Grandpa, coaching the bowl game, as Corey Grant picks up about six for Auburn on first down. So how will the Tigers respond now in the fourth quarter, trailing by four, as Wisconsin's on top 21-17?
Four chances, but only one champion. The College Football Playoff on ESPN. Hallelujah.
Let's check our hot topics around college football, brought to you by Outback Steakhouse, and nothing hotter than the semifinals coming up. We've been waiting a long time for a college football playoff, and it has arrived, and it is today. The Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual, the Allstate Sugar Bowl. Which two teams will advance to the college football playoff championship game in Arlington?
Well, the hot topics for me is Oregon's secondary and then Cardale Jones, as that's, you know, it's going to be a second start against a pretty darn good defense.
Starting the fourth quarter on the ground, Cameron Artis Payne, very close to a first down.
Like he's shy a little bit.
That'll make it third down and a foot. And Melvin Gordon, if he has a big fourth quarter, he might break Barry Sanders' all-time record for most rushing yards in a single season. 84 yards shy of Sanders' record as of now. Artis Payne, second effort, gets the first down for Auburn.
There's that toughness again we're talking about. But I can't undersell how well this defensive front has played for Wisconsin. They've given them lots of different looks. They're not a very big group. They're giving you a lot of movement, but they have done a great job of schematic discipline and eye discipline.
Artis Payne gets to the sideline. Dragged out at midfield by Tanner McAvoy. But it seemed like that misdirection caught Wisconsin napping.
See, they give you a lot of different movement, but it's the same play. It's just a simple power to the right side. It's all you do. McAvoy did a very good job of using the sideline as an extra defender. When you're in that position, it doesn't matter that you make a big hit. It just matters that you stop him.
Artis Payne closing in on his ninth 100-yard game of the season. Up to 86 with a touchdown. There he goes again. Tripped up after a gain of four. And Matt, your job when you were playing pro football was to be the guy in the middle of a defense to try and deduce what those keys were.
Right.
Make sure that all of that motion didn't fool. What are the keys for an inside linebacker when you see all of that motion across the ball?
Yeah, it's eye discipline. And what I mean by that is just staying with your key. Don't be fooled by all the stuff that's going around it. Auburn does a great job of movement. They give you people moving all over the place, yet it's the same straight handoff.
Corey Grant lost his footing or might have gotten to the sideline. As it is, he stood up at the 23. And we've got an injured Tiger behind the play. Avery Young slow to get up. And some pushing and shoving well after the whistle as well.
This was just a base play. Okay, this is just a simple zone read. And there's not much movement. It's just one step. And then what you have to be able to do is maintain the discipline of scheme. It's your relationship to the guy next to you. If you move and the other guy doesn't, you've created your own hole in the defense.
Nick Marshall spinning outside. Bottled up. He lost a couple. Joe Schobert that time. A more secure tackle as Schobert a couple of times has had a chance to bring down Nick Marshall for negative plays and his missed tackles. He made sure that time.
Yeah, well, let me tell you something. There is such a thing as a good miss, because what he did was allow him to not get going and then everybody else could get there to make it. So Schobert didn't make the tackle. He made the play.
Eighth play of the drive. Marshall to throw. First pass of this drive, and it's a tunnel screen to Melvin Ray. That's diagnosed pretty quickly. Warren Herring actually sagged back off the defensive line and helped on the tackle with Derek Landish. And now a third down right on the doorstep of the red zone for Auburn.
Okay, and so this is where the feet of Nick Marshall come into play. Lots of times right in here, they'll give you a two or three man route and Nick Marshall's feet beat you.
Wisconsin brings a blitz. Pump fake by Marshall. He's looking end zone. He's got a receiver. He's got a touchdown. C.J. Uzomah, his third touchdown of the season. And the Tigers have the lead back.
That was a great throw. Great throw from the pocket by Nick Marshall. A very accurate, small window. Hillary has the coverage, and Uzomah is just going to slide up. It's almost, you're going to see them down around that right sideline. Look at the coverage. It's right there. Uzomah just goes out and gets it.
What a great throw as well, as
phenomenal.
He is getting hit right on the waist. You know, you don't realize how strong Nick Marshall is
or big
until you see him play in person. He's only 210 pounds, but boy, it's 210 pounds of muscle.
I think he's an excellent player. I think you'll see him. He's going to be a quarterback in the National Football League. He may not be the starter, but he'll be on the roster and he will contribute. Yeah, here we are up top, and it's the matchup. Uzomah, who's 6'4 and 265 pounds, against Hillary, who's 5'11 and 190. And what you can't have happen is let him get on top of you. Here's the difference in the play, right there. He stopped. Now, certainly, Hillary can outrun him. But because Uzomah stopped and started right there, and see the eyes come back? That little glance is the difference in the play. When you're in man coverage, keep your eyes on the man. He did not. He snuck a peek. That allowed one separation of difference, a step of difference. And then the throw was a great throw, and Uzomah came down with it.
Nick Marshall made that throw with a 240-pound linebacker draped around his waist.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, we talked to Gus Malzahn yesterday. He said that mentally and physically, Nick Marshall is as tough a guy as he's coached in all of his 25 years of coaching. And you don't realize what a strong player he is until you see him in person. Here's Kenzel Bell on the return. Hard to find in there among all those bodies out to the 30-yard line. Capital One Bowl Mania continues tomorrow night on ESPN. Number 11 Kansas State takes on number 14 UCLA in the Valero Alamo Bowl at 6:45 Eastern. And then Washington, Oklahoma State in the Ticket City Cactus Bowl from Tempe at 10:15. Another doubleheader tomorrow night. I'm Bob Wischusen here with Matt Millen. Quinn Kesnick down in the field. We're actually heading to San Antonio as soon as this game's over. We're going to call the Alamo Bowl tomorrow night on ESPN Radio. So hopefully you can join us for that radio call as well. And Melvin Gordon is not only tracking down Kevin Smith, he might catch Barry Sanders for the most yards in the history of college football in a single season. He's now down to about 81 yards away as he picks up about three on first down, as Wisconsin finds themselves down by three again.
Shoes, I can't say enough about this Wisconsin offensive line. Keep in mind, the last time we saw them, they were getting their rear ends handed to them from an Ohio State team that just beat them up and down 59 squat. And they come out here, and they have played an outstanding game against a good Auburn defense.
Gordon again spins into the secondary near midfield. That's another Wisconsin first down. 13 more yards for Melvin Gordon.
So if anybody was sitting at home and was paying attention to Melvin Gordon, he was sick, and I heard a couple people say, ah, he wants to save himself for the draft. He doesn't want to get hurt. You know, any guy who's a competitor, anytime you have a chance to compete, you take it. And Melvin Gordon is doing just that today.
End around, Kenzel Doe. Boy, it's hard when all those eyes are focused on Melvin Gordon to find 5'8" Kenzel Doe on the jet sweep.
I like him. You know, you look at him, you think he's a returner, but they're using him the right way. I think Andy Ludwig has called himself a very good game. And especially here in the second half, the way he's been able to use Doe and then Corey Clement as well, while you know you're still feeding Melvin Gordon. And I can't say enough about how these receivers have and tight ends have been doing a great job of blocking downfield.
Clement bounces it outside. Inside the 20. You know, you can hear Auburn Tiger fans at home right now, Matt Millen, not necessarily to knock the coaches that are still doing their best for this Auburn team in the bowl game today, but they can't have Will Muschamp take over as the defensive coordinator soon enough, because they are getting run on today. It's over 350 yards rushing for Wisconsin.
Yeah, they are mauling this front. And there's some good players in that front.
Clement, first and goal at the 5.
I'm going to talk about being physical, Shoes. Just being physical at the point. I want you to watch. Look at these guys getting off the ball. Look at Watt. That's a great block. Clement's just run where they ain't. That's all you have to do. The offensive line is doing a great job of coming off the ball. And Watt's little brother is putting on a physical show on these backers.
Clement again. This time he's going to lose one. Ben Bradley, his second year at Auburn, first as a starter, came through. His fourth tackle for loss this season. Now it's second down and goal at the 6, and Melvin Gordon comes back in. You mentioned Derek Watt. JJ's here. The Houston Texans season is done, but he might be lifting some MVP hardware. Yeah. He had that kind of year.
He had a phenomenal year. You know, he reminds me of Howie Long. He really does. He's just got that kind of athleticism.
Second down and goal. Gordon drives for the goal line. Is he in? No signal yet. It is a Wisconsin touchdown. And the Badgers answer right back.
And offensive coordinator Andy Ludwig has said this: I'm putting the ball in the hands of Gordon and Clement, and I'm trusting my offensive line to do the rest. And yes, Watt does a nice job. Costigan does a nice job. Traylor does a nice job. Everybody on that offensive front got their guy. But it was the finish and a fumble, actually. And he recovered his own fumble. But Gordon's put on a show here today.
7 plays, 70 yards, all running plays. And Wisconsin is now up to 369 yards rushing. And this extra point, an important one, it stretches the lead to 4. Under 8 minutes to go. 2 more touchdowns on the ground today for Melvin Gordon. He's got 28 on the season. Check that, that's his 3rd, make it 29 on the year.
The 2015 Outback Bowl is brought to you by Outback Steakhouse. Outback, no rules, just right. And great clips. It's gonna be great.
The brand new trophy that will be handed out to the winner of the Outback Bowl. And that is 60 pounds of crystal. Will it go to Wisconsin or will it go to Auburn? We've got just under 8 minutes left to decide. Melvin Gordon with 3 touchdowns to go along with 230 yards rushing. Bob Wischusen here with Matt Millen and Quint Kesnick. So now Wisconsin holds serve and it's back in Auburn's court.
And we've seen 4 lead changes here in this game. And both defenses, while trying, have not been able to hold the other.
Corey Grant, short kick, only down to the 6. He gets ahead of steam. Out to the 29-yard line. So pretty good field position for Auburn. As the Tigers have it back, and we talked about the fact that we had 2 of the best runners in America in our game today. Cameron Artis Payne, 18 carries, 90 yards, a touchdown, 5 yards per carry. Matt, that's respectable in any game, but pales in comparison to the performance of Melvin Gordon.
Melvin Gordon has shown us everything. He's shown power, he's shown running behind his pads, he's shown make you miss, and he's shown great speed.
Artis Payne finds room on first down, caught from behind, dragged down by Arthur Goldberg. It's a gain of 6, though.
You know, every time they get into a different formation, you'll watch this Wisconsin defense, and they're calling out what the formation is and what the tendencies are. Watch them, now they'll adjust. Now, that was a blitz, so they didn't.
Breaking tackles is Cameron Artis Payne. That's a good run. Out to about the 46, maybe the 47-yard line, a gain of 12, and an Auburn first down.
And over 100 yards for him. The only thing they haven't done is feed him. This is a talented back.
Right up the gut again, it's Artis Payne. Crosses the 50, 6 more for Auburn.
Artis Payne, I love how complete he is. I love the fact that you ask him to block on protections and he's stout as stout can be. You ask him to carry the ball inside or outside, he can do it. He catches it as well. Just a good all-around player.
His 9th 100 rushing yard game this season. Marshall, strong throw. Sammy Coates has been quiet, but he picks up a first down here.
They have 3 guys, actually more, but 3 main guys who can make plays. Coach, for whatever reason, has been in and out all game long. He is a big-time playmaker. Artis Payne's another one. And Nick Marshall can do the same thing with his arm and with his feet.
3rd catch for Coates for only 24 yards, and he's back on the sideline. Trying to turn the corner as Ricardo Lewis cuts it back. Spinning off Badgers down to the 25-yard line for 15 more. What happened to the defense we saw from both of these groups in the first half?
I was just going to say, if you're a defensive aficionado, close your eyes. But if you love offense, this is the game to watch.
Artis Payne inside the 15, cut down at about the 14-yard line. And Quint, you're down there. It seems like they might have to get the oxygen out for both defenses.
Both defenses have reached their tipping point, and you see it showing up on this possession in poor tackling from Wisconsin. This game's a shootout. I think the last team possess the ball is going to win this. Both defenses are toast.
Here's Artis Payne to the 9.
So you keep your eyes on that clock. It's 5.5 minutes to go. So if you concede this touchdown here, Auburn goes back up on top by 3. Wisconsin then would have a full 4.5 minutes to work the entire field. Maybe more.
Quan Bray was a little late coming into the huddle, as now Auburn will try and get set with less than 10 to get the playoff. Corey Grant, about 1.5 yards shy of the first down. So under 4:45 to go, and it's 3rd down inside the 10.
And so, Shoes, here's what matters. So you've bent the whole time as a defense. This is the only play that matters for you right now. You have to stop them here and force them to go for it on 4th down to see if they make a decision. This is a huge play defensively. If you're Wisconsin, let's see if they don't bring some pressure. They're in man.
Flags down.
Going to be on the offense.
Well, this changes things in a big way.
False start. Offense. Number 71. 5-yard penalty. 3rd down.
Down by 4. A field goal doesn't give you the lead. Makes it a 1-point game. On 3rd down and about 2.5 to 3, you might think it's 4-down territory. Right. Now what has to happen on this 3rd down? Where if it's 4th and what, would you go for it?
Well, that's going to be a tough call. But now, see the difference. Last time they were bunched in, now everything's spread out. They're trying to get defenders out of the box as much as possible. They're sitting in a zone. See the motion, nobody moves. It's a draw.
And Artis Payne brought down all the way back to the 15. Now it's 4th down and about 11. And now you're almost compelled to kick the field goal, even though it won't give you the lead. Maybe you use your timeouts. Maybe Gus Malzahn feels like with 3.5 minutes to go, his defense can't get a stop. Do you go for it?
Trotter, phenomenal play. They were going to option off of him. They were going to leave him unblocked. He didn't bite on Nick Marshall. He sets up this 4th down. This is a great play by Trotter. Watch him outside. Comes back. I circled the wrong guy, but phenomenal play sets up this 4th down.
4th down and 11. Play clock winding down.
Watch the feet of Nick Marshall. They play the zone.
He floats it in the end zone. And it is dropped, but a flag down. They wanted Sammy Coates. Shelton was there in coverage. It'll be pass interference in the end zone on Sojourn Shelton. So Malzahn rolled the dice, and that floater cost Shelton a penalty.
Pass interference. Defense, number 8. The foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, the ball will be placed at the 2-yard line, 1st and goal.
I love this call by Gus Malzahn. You bring in Sammy Coates, you're just basically throwing it up. And he grabbed him. And Sojourn was in good position. He didn't have to do it. But Coach did a nice job of working his body back inside to give himself a chance. That's awesome.
So now it's 1st and goal at the 2 after the penalty. Artis Payne at the goal line. He's in. Auburn's got the lead back on a Cameron Artis Payne touchdown.
Scoring that quickly could have been a blessing for Wisconsin. Gives them a little bit more time. Wisconsin also has all 3 timeouts.
And they also don't have to have the touchdown.
Exactly.
As if Auburn's able to complete the extra point, still only would be a three-point lead. So the penalty in the end zone on Sojourn Shelton sets up Auburn at the two. One play later, Cameron Artis Payne goes over from 2 yards out. What an Outback Bowl. 2:55 to go here in Tampa. We are closing in on game time in the college football playoff. Back-to-back semifinal games beginning with the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. Less than 2 hours away. Heisman Trophy winner Marcus Mariota and Oregon taking on Florida State. The winner advances to meet the winner of the All-State Sugar Bowl between Alabama and Ohio State at 8:30 Eastern. And there is the Heisman winner making his way into the stadium in Pasadena. 5 Eastern over on ESPN. Oregon and Florida State begin the college football playoff semifinals. And we can only hope, for the sake of Kirk Herbstreit, Chris Fowler, and Brad Nessler and Todd Blackledge and their crews, that their games are anywhere near as entertaining as our game has been here at the Outback Bowl.
You know, Shoes, some players you wait to see and they exceed expectations. Mariota was that for me, and today Melvin Gordon has been that for me.
That's Matt Millen. I'm Bob Wischusen. Quinn Kesnick down on the field, and here comes Melvin Gordon. And Matt, you mentioned it. 3 timeouts, 2:55 on the clock. So Wisconsin, they can do whatever they want to do offensively. They've got the time to run the ball, and that's been their bread and butter.
Andy Ludwig has the full complement of his entire playbook. Not be afraid to run the football. He can run his jet sweeps. He can run his reverses. All those things are big. They want to be able to keep the ball in the hands of Melvin Gordon.
Instead, it's the sweep, and Clement is brought down shy of the 30-yard line. Jermaine Whitehead, Jonathan Mincy, both up in run support. A modest gain on first down.
Yeah, I would have a little bit more pace here than this take your good old time, because you're going to run out at the other end here. First downs are important.
A field goal would tie, but running the ball combined with huddling up, that might cost them. Here's Gordon. There he goes again.
It's amazing.
With a stiff arm. And that stops the clock. And he takes a late hit.
And a flag.
They're going to tack on 15 more.
And Frost knew it when he did it. See him holding his head over there on the sideline.
That's the second time that Melvin Gordon has been hit late out of bounds.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, late hit, out of bounds. Defense number 17, 15-yard penalty from the out-of-bounds spot, automatic, first down.
You're going to watch 17 come inside out. He's running and he's hustling hard. Here he comes. He knows he's got to stop him. That one, and he knows, watch him hold, he knows it. He starts his hitting motion inside. He should have pulled back, though. Gus Malzahn not happy. Pulled him out of the game.
No game. Montrevious Adams tripped up Gordon.
So, Shoes. So, if you're this defense right now of Auburn, nothing matters the whole game. All that stuff that's happened to this point is meaningless. All that matters are the snaps ahead of you. So, okay, we haven't held the edge very well. We haven't come downhill very well. Now is the time to do it. Somebody's got to rally them and get them. You just have to make 3 more plays.
Now it's Corey Clement. Finds a crease. And that brings up 3rd down and about 3.5. And barely on the edge of field goal range now, Wisconsin with 1:13 to go.
And a timeout. And a good timeout. Nice job of managing the clock here.
It looked like Barry Alvarez was the caller of the timeout from the sideline. So we'll step away for just a moment. A minute and 11 to go in the Outback Bowl. What a game we've had between Wisconsin and Auburn. It's our coverage of the Outback Bowl. Bob Wischusen here with Matt Millen. Quinn Kesnick down on the field. And a huge play coming up here for Wisconsin. 1:11 on the clock. They still have two timeouts, third down and four. And they're about a yard away from what they thought would be comfortable field goal range.
I think this is four down territory. I take this on fourth down. You got the best rusher in the country. Let him run.
Stumbling is Stave. He couldn't get it to Gordon. Somehow Gordon found the football, and he might have lost a half yard.
That's
so
okay.
So now what do you do on fourth down if you're Barry Alvarez? Do you try a long field goal to tie?
I wouldn't. You have the best runner in all of college football. You have the offensive line that's been getting after it all day. You bring it back, and let me tell you something. They've had 28 plays here in the second half. Only three passes, 25 runs. Hand the ball to Gordon. This is actually a phenomenal job of Gordon being able to get hold of the ball. This thing, look at that. He grabs it and then still is able to try to gain any. He gets back to line of scrimmage. That's an amazing play.
So it's fourth down and five. Rafael Gaglianoni is the freshman kicker from Brazil. And it looks like rather than having him try a 51-yarder after the timeout, Barry Alvarez, he thinks his percentage play is to go for it. And now Gus Malzahn will call a timeout.
I agree with
him.
On
the Auburn sideline.
Auburn takes its second timeout of the half. 30 seconds in duration.
Quinn Kesnick is down on the field. And Q, how close do you think Barry Alvarez came to sending the field goal unit out there? He had Gaglianoni out as part of that huddle.
Well, special teams coach is Jeff Jenick, and he's got the black polo with the red stripe. And he was perched on Alvarez's shoulder saying, he can make it. He can make it. Coach Jenick told me that Gaglianoni can hit from 55 in this direction. At halftime, he specifically told me that. But Coach Alvarez is not willing to roll the dice on his freshman from Brazil.
That's because he can't say his name. He couldn't say, hey, you did get boot. I forget it. Give me Gordon.
So after the Auburn timeout, any chance that Wisconsin has rests on this play. Fourth down and five.
Get your safeties down. It doesn't matter. They're running the football.
Stavi will throw. It's bobbled and held on to. A first down catch by Sam Arneson. And for the third time in the game, Wisconsin converts on fourth down.
That is the best throw Stave's made all day at the most important time.
Wisconsin with only one timeout left. Stavi to throw again. He's looking end zone. Incomplete. Overthrew Alex Erickson. So now it's second down and 10 at the 26.
You have one timeout left. You're in field goal territory. You want to get a better position. This needs to be Melvin Gordon.
You wonder if that's the only shot that Barry Alvarez gives the thumbs up to.
Yeah.
Does he now get in the headset and say, guys, run it with 41 seconds to go? Stavi has thrown three interceptions, two of them down to the five-yard line. Five-man rush. Stavi to throw.
There he is.
Dumps it off to Gordon. Melvin Gordon can't break the tackle at the 21 of Rudy Ford and Jonathan Mincy. And now the final timeout will be called by Alvarez as Melvin Gordon shaken up on that play. He's hurt. He's over on the sideline, bent over and being looked at by the trainers.
This was a good call. You're expecting that you're going to have some kind of pressure. You give it to Gordon underneath. This time, you weren't able to get the blocks from your receivers who've been doing it all game long. But I really like the call by Andy Ludwig.
And the third man in there, Montrevious Adams, that seemed to be the hit that shook up Melvin Gordon.
Yeah, well, because they called a timeout, he can come back in and play. Had they not called a timeout and he'd gone out for injury, he couldn't come in.
Take one more look. And again, watch Montrevious Adams, who's only 6'4", 306 pounds.
Yeah.
Ouch. So now the decision for Barry Alvarez, third down and five at the 21-yard line, but no timeouts. You're down to 29 seconds to go. If you run the ball here and put it between the hash marks, a sense of urgency to get the field goal unit out there.
Now you have. Now you're going to throw. Now you're going to use Stave, but I'm dumping it. Nothing down the field, just small underneath throws.
It's a first down. Out of bounds at the 11-yard line goes Kenzel Doe. So now with 24 seconds, you are in a position where you could take some shots at the end zone before settling for the field goal.
And you're still far enough away at 11 yards with the pass rush. You'll have about 15 yards before the end zone. And so you can work the back of the end zone to get your secondary back, and you can still throw it back underneath to a tight end or a crossing route.
And Melvin Gordon's back on the field.
Offset in a passing formation.
Here comes the blitz. Stave into the end zone. Does a flag come out?
No.
Alex Erickson got tied up with the Reezy. And Wisconsin doesn't get the benefit of the call in their end zone. Certainly not the benefit that Auburn got at the other end of the field that set up their go-ahead touchdown.
This is where Wisconsin does not have great speed. Okay, and you can use speed down here in crossing routes. But Therese, that's great coverage, and that's a great non-call. You can use speed in the red zone with crossing routes. They don't really have anybody who can run except for Gordon. See if you don't throw my little wheel down here.
Play clock at three. Incomplete, intended for Kenzel Doe. Again, Therese was there in coverage. Now it's third down, and now you're down with 15 seconds, Matt, to the point. This next pass has to get in the end zone or out of bounds.
Yeah.
Now you can't run your field goal unit out there quickly enough if you're tackled on the field of play.
Okay, so what you also have are guys who can't run. So what you have to be able to go to is bunches, get them backed off, or some rubs or slash picks. That's what you have to be able to do down here. Let's see if they do it. Here comes the, on the top side. You're putting in a bunch. That's very smart. That makes you defensively back off. Here it is up top.
Here comes the blitz. Stave, look at end zone. Incomplete. And a smart throw by Stave.
It was.
He threw it over the head of Erickson and made sure that if Erickson didn't make a play on the ball, you don't sacrifice the field goal attempt. And now the freshman, Rafael Gaglianone, will come on to see if we may be headed to overtime.
So he had the one-on-one on the backside. Doesn't have the speed to be able to pull it off. It was actually good coverage, but a smart move by Stave.
29 yards away. And one more timeout to burn for Gus Malzahn, so why not let the freshman
Auburn
think about it?
Takes his third and final timeout of the half, 30 seconds in duration.
Well, he's from Sao Paulo, Brazil. He doesn't know what freezing is. So he's good.
He made 12 in a row coming into today. His long this season was back in week one against LSU from 51 yards away. So he was second in the Big Ten in field goal percentage during the season at 85%. And he has not missed from inside of 30, 7 for 7. So all the numbers are there for Gaglianone, but none of them have carried the pressure of this game.
Yeah, and the other thing is you're down pretty close, but you're on a hash. And keep in mind that the college hashes are wider, so it's a pretty good angle from here.
Drew Meyer, the punter, will hold. Right down the middle.
He kicked touchdown. Remember Gary Upemium? Remember when he first came into the league and he said, I kick touchdown.
31-31. And barring a miracle return by Auburn, the Outback Bowl's heading to overtime.
keep in mind, there was one missed kick in this game. And it was from Auburn. They missed the field goal after hitting a big, long one. He missed a 45-yarder.
Of course, three turnovers by Wisconsin, all in plus territory, and two interceptions thrown by Joel Stavi down to the five-yard line. So both of these teams have had chances to score more and have had points taken off the board. And we are now tied at 31, heading to potentially overtime, although I seem to remember a football game last season where there was a long return. Wasn't there a return last year that Auburn was involved in?
Yeah, it wasn't
was
too
replayed
bad.
A couple of times.
It was kind of very Iron Bowl-ish. Now, if I'm Wisconsin, I'm driving this ball on the ground through and make somebody have to handle it in the middle, because with 7 seconds left, I don't want to see another Iron Bowl.
I don't see Chris Davis back there. It is Corey Grant, the return man to the left, has brought several back. It's a short kick, poots down to about the 12, but a chance for Grant. And no kick six here, and we are headed to overtime at the Outback Bowl. So a terrific game between Auburn and Wisconsin will continue after we check in with Chris Cotter.
Bob, Matt, Happy New Year. Let's tell you what's happening over on ABC. Buffalo Wild Wings Citrus Bowl. Minnesota taking on Mizzou. And watch Mad Max Williams. He's going to hurdle not just one defender, but two defenders inside the red zone to score this 54-yard touchdown pass and catch. But it's 19-17. Mizzou on top at the start of the fourth, guys.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. Is that the prize? That ought to be the trophy. The man-sized blooming onion here at the Outback Bowl as we're headed to overtime. All-time Auburn, couple of games over 500. Wisconsin 5-5. And extra football. You and I have had a fun bowl season. We called
really
the Pinstripe
have.
Bowl at Yankee Stadium over the weekend at Penn State. And Boston College played overtime. And now Auburn and Wisconsin play overtime here in Tampa.
Well, remember at the start of the game, we wondered how the attitudes would be of each team. And that they have put what's behind them. And they've played, both these teams have played really well here today. Now, defensively, they've struggled at parts, different parts of the game. But I think the mindset coming in, you had to be pleased with.
Now the clock's off the board. Now right. It's your ball at the 25, my ball at the 25. Considering the way that Wisconsin has run the football today, Wisconsin getting it to overtime advantage Badgers, you think this is still a toss-up game?
I think actually from the 25-yard line, I think it's actually an advantage for Wisconsin, and here's why. A big part of what Auburn does is the big play down the field. From the 25-yard line, you don't really have that.
Okay, gentlemen, this is the overtime period. A little bit different here. You cannot defer. The winner of the toss must elect offense, defense, or which end of the field you want to play on. The loser will have the remaining option. We will not toss again after this. If we go to the next overtime period, the loser of this toss will elect offense or defense. You understand? Auburn, you're the visitors. Heads, tails, tails, heads. Heads, heads is his call. It is heads. You want defense. It means you're going to be on offense. Which end of the field you want to play on? This side. Swap sides, gentlemen.
We want to defend that goal. That's what I defend. Yeah,
you want to go this way?
Yeah, we want to defend this goal.
You're going to be on offense. Which end do you want to go?
This side.
Correct. Wisconsin will be on offense at the 25-yard line on this end of the field, first and 10.
That's why they always have offensive guys making those decisions.
So Wisconsin will start with the football, and we'll head down to Q.
That was a situation where safeties coach Bill Bush was about 20 yards on the field. He was going to make the call himself. Momentary confusion from Caputo. The deal here is that the Auburn fan section in our end zone to our left, that is 100% blue and orange to our left. The right end zone is more heavily populated by Wisconsin fans.
So it's smart that Wisconsin wants to make sure crowd noise isn't a factor. Head towards the friendly end zone. It was their choice which end to play towards, and they will play offense towards at least an end zone that's at worst 50-50 in terms of all Auburn fans. So here we go. High formation with Gordon dotting the I. loss of a yard and a half on first down. Casanova McKenzie comes through to make the tackle.
Yeah, very aggressive. Very aggressive from the linebacker spot. They're having, you got an eight-man front. He's been running an eight-man fronts all day. Watch McKenzie's gonna take that gap right there. At that linebacker, as soon as it opens, boom, he's hitting it. That's well done.
Melvin Gordon lined up at first as an H-back, but now motions in to the tailback spot.
Same thing. Look at this. This is all stacked up front here.
Some misdirection, and Melvin Gordon, not a ton on second down. Chris Frost was there to trip him up after a gain of about three, so now it's third down and eight.
So you have those eight and nine-man fronts. How do you run at it? Well, you have to run to the side that has the fewer numbers, number one, or two. You start one way and come back the other way. That's why we've been seeing those jet sweeps to the edge so much.
Blitz coming. Stavi up the seam. It's a first down catch inside the 10, down to about the 9-yard line. Troy Fumagalli was able to wall off a defender and make the reception.
You said it right. Watch Fumagalli use his body to the inside. That's exactly what you have to do. You have pressure coming from inside. There's no one in the middle. Fumagalli knows, get the defender outside. I make that throw easier for Stavi, and Stavi was right on the money. Well done.
Huge third down conversion for Wisconsin. So it's first and goal. Hand off to the fullback for the first time today. Derek Watt gets his hands on the football and picks up two.
Derek Watt's played a great game here today. He has been the battering ram all game long. He's been picking people up inside out, and he's allowed both those runners to be able to have big games, Gordon and Clement.
Melvin Gordon gets bottled up right at the line of scrimmage. Third down and goal coming up. Again, it's Casanova McKenzie on the tackle for the Tiger.
Okay, so you run an eight-man fronts, and you see a backer like McKenzie making a play. That tells you the offensive line hasn't been able to get to second level. Or the fullback. In this particular case, Watt does get to where he's supposed to, but McKenzie beats his block and is able to get there. You know, watch McKenzie sitting right back here. You got to get a second-level guy inside. Not in particular instance, the guard has to look back in, and it sets up this third.
Melvin Gordon on the sideline for third down and goal. Stavi to throw. Extends the play. Still keeping it alive. Into the end zone. Incomplete. Off the left hand of Fumagalli. So the War Eagle defense gets a stop, and Wisconsin will have to try a field goal attempt here in overtime.
All that matters defensively for Auburn is that you stop them right here. Ooh. Well, I don't know why Corey Clement didn't try to catch that ball.
He was right at the pylon, yeah, and could have just stepped inside the pylon for a score. 25 yards away for points in overtime. Gaglianone forced overtime a moment ago, and he's good again. So now the Tigers can win it with a touchdown.
So if you're Wisconsin defense, you got to hold for three plays. It's all you have to do.
And the number one problem, the biggest regret that Gus Malzahn, that Rhett Lashley talked about with us yesterday in the Iron Bowl, scoring in the red zone.
Yes.
That was where they left the Iron Bowl on the field. They thought they had that game won. Certainly between the 20s, you can make the argument that they did. Nick Marshall had 505 yards of total offense in that game. But from the 25, the 20-yard line and in, they left a lot of points on the field.
And it's funny you bring up Nick Marshall, because his feet right here are a major weapon and one that's really hard to defend.
So now Auburn's chance, and they can win it with six. Marshall changes the play. Artis Payne, tackle for loss. Joe Schubert got him around the ankles for a loss of two.
Schubert's had himself a heck of a game here today. When he hasn't made the tackle, he's made the play. Very smart game. He's played really well here today.
Sammy Coates is on the field. To the short side of the field at the top of your screen. Widest man left is Coates. And they'll throw a little wide receiver screen to him. He gets bottled up. No gain. It'll be third down and 12. And here's Wisconsin's chance to get off the field on defense. Again, it's Joe Schobert making the stop.
Yeah, it's Schobert this time makes the tackle, but the other guys are making the play. Schobert inside out, but because they hemmed him in, he had nowhere to go. Schobert was able to make that play, sets up this third and 11, third and 12.
It might be a double pass.
He can throw it.
It's a throwback to Nick Marshall. And Wisconsin not fooled. So Gus Malzahn dialed up the trick play. Joe Schobert
again,
part of the group that stayed home. And now Auburn will try a field goal.
That is a great. Watch Schobert on the top side. He sees it right away. He's going to throw this ball backwards. Now watch Schobert. He feels it. He just knows he's got to get out there. Doesn't know where. But what a great heads-up play to set up this field goal try.
Barry Alvarez wants to ice the kicker.
So see how you like the cold room. I think by now he's learned his kicker's name. Pretty sure.
Seconds in duration.
Daniel Carlson's one for two. He made a long one, but earlier on in the second half, this from 44 yards away, just pushed it. Outside the right upright. That from the right hash. This kick will be from the left hash from almost the exact same distance. This will be about a 45-yard attempt.
Somebody in the stands right here from Wisconsin is giving him the ooga booga right now. I can feel it.
Is that what you call it?
Yeah, you get the old ooga booga. It worked many times.
See if Daniel Carlson is impervious to the ooga booga. 45 yards away to extend overtime. Will it bend inside the upright? It does not! It hits the upright! And Wisconsin wins the Outback Bowl in overtime.
The Ooga Booga gets you every time. The other miss, and it looked like he pushed the same thing. This doinked it off that right upright. A matter of about 3 inches, Barry Alvarez is a happy man.
The seniors for Wisconsin went to Barry Alvarez and asked him to coach the bowl game. He wasn't sure. He lost the last one in the Rose Bowl 2 years ago when he replaced the head coach in that spot. He wins today, and he's standing by with Quinn Kesman.
Coach, how do you best describe this scene? I haven't seen student-athletes celebrate like this in a long time.
Well, you know, they're letting off a lot of steam, a lot of emotion. They put a lot into this game. They've been through so much in the last 3 weeks and the seniors through their career. But to have to play a game like this, to beat a very good Auburn team in overtime, They're just letting it all out.
I want to start with Melvin Gordon. How do you characterize the effort you saw today from him?
He's the best. I mean, he took some shots today, but he kept fighting. You saw him make yards in a lot of different ways. He is special.
You took some shots. You talked about swagger. We saw it. You went for it on fourth down three times, Coach. And I see the smirk. What was it like for you to be on the sideline?
It was good. It felt good. I had tremendous communication with our staff. Our staff did an unbelievable job. They were very professional throughout this. We had very good communication. There was never any hesitation what we wanted to do and how we were going to do it.
You think about closure for the senior group.
Yeah.
What's it like for them now to walk off the field with that W after a rough, turbulent month?
You know what? These guys have won a lot of football games, but they haven't won a lot of bowl games.
Watch out. You better watch out.
Expertly done by Quint Kesnick. He delayed that interview just long enough, almost as if the senior players from Wisconsin said, ask the coach just enough questions for us to get over and drench him with the Gatorade. That's exactly what happened. And how about that feeling for Barry Alvarez? Asked by the senior class to coach the bowl game. He wins the Outback Bowl, gets a Gatorade bath, gets carried off the field. And our Capital One player of the game, of course, why not? Melvin Gordon, Matt Millen, he was tremendous.
He had a phenomenal game, and he deserves all of it, 250 yards. But let me just say one thing. Joel Stavi, when he had to make the throws at the end of the game, he came through for him. So good job by Stavi going into his last year. But Melvin Gordon, we're going to see a lot of Melvin Gordon. We're going to be hearing a lot of Melvin Gordon. He'll be the first back taken in the NFL draft coming up. And he will have an outstanding career.
You can't imagine a bowl game being more fun than the one that we just had the privilege to call. Terrific effort from Auburn, a wonderful performance by Wisconsin. And the Badgers survive in overtime, 34-31, to win one for the Big Ten. Coming up next here on ESPN2, it's SportsCenter. So long from Tampa.
This.